Good evening. Welcome to the May 16th meeting of the Planning Board of the Town of Cape Elizabeth. Before us, we have minutes from our prior meeting of April 25, 2006. Are there any comments or is a motion in order regarding these minutes? Paul, motion to accept the minutes as submitted. We have a motion to accept the minutes as submitted. It's been seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? And the motion carries. We have some correspondence before us tonight. We have a letter from the town attorney regarding the Jordan Farm subdivision, the March 2006 issue of zoning practice, the Planning Commissioner's Journal from the spring of 2006, a memo from the Conservation Commission regarding the Jordan Farm subdivision, a memo from the Fire Chief regarding the Elliott Private Accessway Permit, a memo from the Conservation Commission regarding Spurwink Woods, a memo from Spurwink Woods LLC regarding Spurwink Woods. We have also been receiving emails through this afternoon, at least when I checked, I still had some coming in. And I believe any emails or submissions that were sent to us today have been printed, and we have had an opportunity to look at them prior to tonight's hearing. As I said before, anybody who has sent an email, you are certainly welcome to check with the town planner to ensure that that has become part of the record. There was a suggestion made prior to tonight's meeting that we take business out of order, anticipating that some of the items may not take a great deal of time, and we ought to try to deal with them first. So do we have a motion in that regard?
So I'd like to make a motion that we take business out of order and start with the new business first.
Okay.
With the Jordan subdivision, then Spurwink Woods afterwards.
Motion has been made and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? Okay, the motion carries. So under new business, we have the Elliott Private Accessway Permit Resource Protection Permit. Donald Elliott is requesting a private accessway permit and resource protection permit to construct a driveway for a lot located at 43 Hannaford Cove Road, Section 19-7-9, Private Accessway Permit Completeness, and Section 19-8-3, Resource Protection Permit Completeness. At this point, I would invite the applicant to the podium and introduce the project and bring us up to date.
Put those right up there. I guess, you know, this speaker's working. My name is Herbert Gray. I'm a consulting engineer, and I've been hired by Don Elliott to assist him in his accessway permit. On Hannaford Cove Road, I'm sure you all got your package in there. This is 45, I think. This is 41, and they determined that this building in here would be 43 Hannaford Cove Road. And on this plan, we show the Hannaford Cove Road, the private end going in here. We have 1 foot contours. We have the location of the septic system. And Al Frick did the wetlands. Indication there is a small area of wetland right in here, which is an RP2 wetland, approximately 1,068 square feet. There will be filling right in there going through, and we'll have the drainage goes across this way towards Yokobaskus land, and we'll have a pipe there that'll take the drainage, and we have a turnaround here for access vehicles to get in and get out. And these wetlands here come out to be an RP2 wetland in the fact that they're less than 1 acre in size. So they do not affect this property here. The site distance coming out of here, let me get the other plan out for if I may. This shows a plan and profile of the private way coming into the property. And this also shows the existing contours, and it shows our proposed contours showing the drainage going away from Hannaford Cove Road. One of the distance that we have here on site distance, we have no problem at all seeing this way on Hannaford Cove Road, you can see practically all the way to the ocean. On this side of Hannaford Cove Road, there is a little bit of a hill and a turn in the road right here. And there are a couple of shrubs right here that we show just short of the neighbor's driveway. And I was out with Bob Malley, and if those shrubs were cut along the road right away on that side, why then you would be able to see approximately 150 feet that way, which is what is necessary for site distance in this area. There will be a water line coming off the water line to go in here, and we have a Central Main Power there, and we'll have some underground conduit coming in through here servicing the proposed house, and we show those installations here. Also in here we show, although it's very hard to see, and in a further plan I will indicate it so you can see, but the retaining wall that we show here, which we plan to build. This section is right through this area here, which is station 1 plus 16, and it shows a 12-inch pipe with a flow coming this way, and the 12-inch pipe will have a concrete collar around it, which will fit right into these standard block units, and this is called a mechanically stabilized earth wall, and they have geosynthetic reinforcement coming across here, and of course we have all new earth in here, gravel borrow and so forth, which will help hold the wall up. And the way this wall is designed is it has a type B under drain, which will run from the pipe, it will connect to the pipe, and it runs underground up approximately at this point right here, which will be the end of the wall, and also on both sides of the wall, and it will come up here as far as the wall comes here, and this wall here will come up and probably make a curve around here for a few feet. The under drain probably would stop right in about this area here. As you can see, the depth of the fill of the existing and what the proposed is right in through here, and right in this area here we've got 5 or 6 feet of fill. So and there we have a water line coming through, and about the water line, right now we show a 1-inch water line, but as I understand it, because of the accessway having a radius of only 10 feet and so forth, the fire chief decided that his, probably his ladder truck may not be able to make the turn to get in there. And he has recommended that we put in a sprinkler system for the house, which we will do. And I'm checking with Portland Water District now, but I believe that's going to require a 2-inch line instead of a 1-inch line. And of course, the fact that the house will be over 300 feet from the line, we have to put in a meter pit, which is shown right there, for the water. That's Portland Water District. And the drainage on this thing will be coming down this way on both sides, and you can see the 12-inch pipe is underneath. And this type B under drain, as the water spreads down through, it goes through the gravel basin. We have a 3/4-inch clean crushed stone, 1 foot in back of the wall, which the water will run down and run into the under drain and run out the 12-inch pipe. And that's the way the drainage is scheduled to be handled. And the only possible one thing I noticed in the comments I think that Ost had was that he was recommending that we probably need a guardrail instead of having a, if we have a guardrail, put the guardrail in. You can put a guardrail in with this wall. It would probably narrow this 14 feet up to 13 feet because you have to have 3 feet from the wall to come into the guardrail. They recommend 3 feet from the wall, and you get the thickness of the guardrail. So it would probably wound up being approximately 7 feet, which would narrow this 20 feet minus 7, it'll leave you 13 feet instead of 14 in that particular area. And I think the guardrail is probably necessary, should be there for safety reasons.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Gay. The first order of business for tonight is for the board to consider the issue of completeness.
Okay.
And I appreciate all the detail, but I suspect that we may hold off on a real substantive review of your project until the public hearing stage.
Okay.
And I hope I didn't cut you off. Was there anything else that you wanted to?
No, I believe in Maureen's packet there, she's listed the checklist.
Yep.
We've got, and I think it speaks for itself.
Okay, thank you. And as we discuss the issue of completeness, our town planner is going to fix the nameplates in front of us. This is the planning board and not the town council. So, is there any discussion or thoughts, comments on the issue of completeness for this application?
I had a question for Maureen. And
can you stall a little bit, John?
I think I can answer there's a lot of comments, I think, from our town engineer about the maintenance agreement or things that should be included in the maintenance agreement. And is that for a discussion afterwards? The fact that we just have a maintenance agreement as part of the package is what we're deciding right now?
Typically what the board does is when you make a determination of completeness, you're saying that there's sufficient information that's been submitted per the ordinance requirements to begin the review. It doesn't at all mean that what is submitted is adequate. So it's, yes, there's an agreement. Does it need more things in it? There's certainly opportunity to do that
later. Okay.
And I do see that there are at least a few people here tonight who neighbor this proposed project. And all we're determining tonight is whether materials are sufficient to begin the review procedure. We're not commenting one way or the other on whether they are adequate. Is there a motion?
The only question I had, Dave, yes. Was the high-intensity soil survey. Does the town staff feel that we need anything more than we have on that issue, given the comments?
I can't remember the last time the planning board required a high-intensity soil survey. The wetlands information was submitted by Al Frick Associates, and they have submitted information on projects many times, and I don't think we've ever found any problems with what they've done. Certainly the board can require that if they want.
No, I wasn't in favor of it, Art. I just wanted to put it out there so that we discussed it and that we're going to pass, that's fine personally with me. I'm prepared to make a motion unless somebody else has a question.
Are there any further questions?
You want a motion?
Sure.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and the materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Don Elliott for a private accessway permit and a resource protection permit to make the lot located at 43 Hannaford Cove Road a buildable lot and construct a driveway across an RP2 wetland be deemed complete.
You have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Motion has been made and seconded by several. Any further discussion? Purposes of your notes, who seconded the motion? Oh, okay, Mr. Kinnunen. Okay. Thank you. Jack, you got the credit. All those in favor? Okay, motion carries. We next need to decide whether to hold a site walk and or public hearing. And I think given the fact that we've received comments from virtually all of the abutters, we ought to do both. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Okay, so we need to come up with a time then for our site walk. We typically do these on Saturday mornings. Now that it's staying lighter out longer, we could also do it during the week. What's the board's pleasure? Want to try it during the week?
My only question, the June workshop session, how is that looking for?
Live and well.
We have a lot to deal with that night?
At least three items.
Okay, so maybe that's not a good.
We could do it before then.
Well, my only concern with that is enough time. Or are you thinking?
Well, I mean, it's not, what if we convened at 6 o'clock? Would that? Well,
that would give us a full hour.
Yeah.
Well, it's 5:30 or so.
5:30, just to make sure we have enough time.
Well, 6 minutes.
I just should alert you that the council is holding a workshop that same night as the planning board, and they're starting it at 6:30, and I'm supposed to be there at 6:30. So you
would only be able to stay.
Yeah. You can do it without me.
What's the date would be the 6th? June 6th, right.
June 6th, yep. Usually start your meetings at 7, and I have to be here at 6:30.
Would you be okay if we started the sidewalk at 5:30? It would give us 45 minutes. Likely we would be done. And if you need to depart early, then we'd carry on without you. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So what date is that again?
June 6th.
Okay, June 6th at 5:30 for the sidewalk. Does that work for the applicant?
June 6th, 2000.
What's the date on that?
June 6th.
Tuesday, June 6th.
June 6th.
June 6th,
yes. 5:30.
I'm out of town all that week.
Oh. Jack just mentioned that he's going to be out of town that week. We could shoot for another time, or Jack could perhaps take a drive-by? Or would you rather?
Yeah, I could take a drive-by myself. Maybe Maureen could get on with me some other time.
Okay.
That'd be fine.
All right. Fair.
I do want to see it.
Okay. So we'll proceed that way then. And then the public hearing would be scheduled for when? Would they be able to submit in time for the June public hearing?
No.
No. Okay.
The submission deadline for the June meeting is the Friday before your workshop.
Okay.
So they couldn't incorporate anything we just...
For the purposes of the applicant, is there, we could try to move the site walk earlier.
For expedited process as much as possible.
Well, let's see if we can find another date early.
Maureen started to say.
You got a Saturday or I mean, another, you want to do it the fourth Tuesday, you can do it next Tuesday at some time.
What's just the
site walk? It's,
we have an extra Tuesday this month.
Yes.
The 30th.
23rd?
Tuesday the 30th after Memorial Day weekend at same time or 5:30?
Yeah, because it shouldn't be more than an hour. Yeah, 5:30. So we'll move it a week.
Jack, are you okay with that one?
I am.
I'm not, so I'll just do whatever he was going to.
All right. So we are now talking about, do we have a problem?
I don't know. I don't have my Little League schedule on here. But that would be fine.
Okay, well, to the extent any of us can't make it, we'll arrange with Maureen to take another look. But it would be Tuesday, May 30th at 5:30. Okay. We do need another motion regarding the public hearing.
I move we have a public hearing.
The application be tabled to the public hearing.
I'm sorry. You want me to read that?
That's okay.
I have it.
Go ahead, Peter.
I move that the above application be tabled to the regular June 20th, 2006 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing will be held.
Okay. Motion's been made by Peter, seconded by Barbara. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Okay. The motion carries. Thank you. The next item on the agenda is the Jordan subdivision. The Jordan family is requesting minor subdivision approval for a three-lot subdivision located at the end of Deer Run Road. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 16-2-3, Minor Subdivision Review. At this point, I would ask the applicant to come forward and summarize any changes to the project since the last meeting. And then we did schedule this for a public hearing, and we will hold the hearing after we hear from the applicant.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I'm Bob Metcalf with Mitchell & Associates, and we're representing the Jordan family on this application. Since the last time we met here and also on the site walk, we've made some changes to the plan based on staff comments and board input. The first change was based primarily from the site walk, where the board had requested that we add street trees along this portion, the lot frontage along Hockey Pond Way. Six trees have been added to that plan. The trees are proposed as 2-inch caliper red maple. Those will be planted at the time once the roadway construction is completed. The other item, which was part of a waiver request that we had before, was the requirement for all of the corners of the right-of-way to be identified with granite monumentation. We had discussions with the Public Works Director and came to an agreement on the location of 7 granite monuments to be identified on the site. The plan has been revised to show that. There will be 2 granite monuments down along the corner of Deer Run and Spurwink. There will be one located at the corner intersection of Deer Run and Hockey Pond Way. The 2 outer corners of the emergency turnaround, and then the corners at the far end of Hockey Pond Way. And as I said, those have been added to the plan. The other change in the plan, which was added to the plan, we had initially shown the first 25 feet of Deer Run to be paved. We revised that to show the required 50 foot of pavement from Spurwink Ave in on the existing portion of Deer Run. The other change in the plan that occurred from some of the comments before, we had come in with the name of Pond Hockey Way, and it was a miscommunication with the police chief. We did revise that to Hockey Pond Way, and that has been added to the plan in the correct format. One of the other comments that came from the police chief through the town engineer was whether or not stop signs were going to be required on this. We spoke with Chief Williams, and he's requested a stop sign be located at the intersection of Deer Run and Spurwink, and that has been shown on the plan. And then he requested an additional one to be located at the intersection of Deer Run and Hockey Pond Way, and that has been added to the plan. In the town engineer's prior review, he had requested some additional dimensional information for the roadway, the emergency turnaround, and the turning radii. That information has been added to the plans and subsequent details. There was a detail for the riprap for the outlet for the drainage on the, along the roadway coming down by the emergency turnaround. It requested that the size of that riprap be added to the detail in the plan. That has been done. He made a recommendation that a stone plunge pool be located at the outlet ends of the two culverts that cross over at this portion of Hopkey Pond Way. We studied that and felt as though that was a very good recommendation. We have revised the plan to address that. One of the other comments from the town engineer was to revise the pavement section for the paved portion of Deer Run Road. The thickness just needed to be adjusted on that in terms of the gravel and the pavement cross-section, and we've revised that detail accordingly. One of the other comments from the town engineer also was to look at revising the construction budget. That has been done. That was submitted to Maureen, I believe, yesterday. I don't know if she's had an opportunity to have that reviewed or not. In terms of, if you want to go into some of the comments that we just received from Maureen, I can address some of those now if you'd like.
Sure.
One, Maureen had requested some additional information on the street tree planting. The trees are keyed on the plan, but tucked up in the upper left-hand corner of the plan actually was a planting schedule that showed the name of the trees and the size of the trees. The other comment and question that was raised by the board during the site walk was the provision of a pedestrian easement over the existing wood tote road that crosses lot one, and the Jordan family are going to retain or reserve a right of pedestrian easement for the family over lot one. A description will be written for that and attached to the deed to be recorded with the deed. The other easements that came up under question and will be written as description attached to the deed will be provisions to allow rights for lots 1, 2, and 3 to have access on Hopkey Pond Way, and also for access on Deer Run Road. In addition to that, the two existing lots that front on Deer Run right now, in their deeds is an easement description to allow passage over the 30-foot easement that was there before. That language will be revised to show a 50-foot wide right-of-way, and that also will be attached to their deeds and recorded at the Cumberland County Register of Deeds. I think that covers all the changes that were requested through staff review and the board review. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Okay, thank you. We do have a public hearing scheduled for this evening, so at this point I'll open it up for the public hearing, and then I'm sure there'll be some questions for you afterwards. So any member of the audience here tonight wanting to speak on the minor subdivision review for the Jordan family, opening the public hearing, please come forward to the podium, identify yourself and your address, and then you're welcome to comment on the application. Seeing that there is no one here for this public hearing, I will now close the public hearing. And at this point, invite the board to begin discussion of this application. Are there any questions for the applicant? Barbara.
Well, just one thing and then one comment. I'll make the comment first. I don't agree about the two stop signs. I think the stop sign by the new lots is totally unnecessary. I can see having one perhaps before you get into a more major arterial, but I think we're going a little stop sign crazy. And, you know, we might not even need one at the end, but if it'll make them happy to get 50%, that's my opinion. And the question I have is, the Planning Commission was very concerned about encroachment into the 250-foot setback. And if you remember, they wanted the lots reconfigured, which is not possible. But I'm wondering, and I don't know whether this is actually part of it, because I didn't read any place that it was, if there could be some kind of a deed restriction in the two lots that are affected, and it's especially one. One lot's only affected in the tiny little corner, that there can be no alteration outside of the building envelope. Have you done that, Bob?
No, we have not done that at this point.
I don't know how everybody else feels, but we've sort of ignored that letter from the Conservation Commission. I'm sorry, I said it wrong. from the Conservation Commission.
And I do recall we discussed this during the site walk, and another idea proposed by the town planner was to require a physical monument. Am I thinking of the right area? Require a physical monument such as a split rail fence or something that would run along that border so that it becomes less difficult for the property owner to say, oh, gee, I didn't know. I wasn't supposed to go beyond this area. So I too echo Barbara's concerns and would like to see something like that in the plan.
One thing we did discuss on the sidewalk, and this is something that's been done on previous projects as well as projects that have been before my board in Kennebunk, where we actually have a medallion that's made up that can be secured along the limits of what that setback line is to identify the limit of clearing on there, rather than having to get in some structural element in terms of a fence that ultimately requires long-term maintenance. And if that's an acceptable, I believe that the applicant would have no trouble doing that.
Can you describe that a little better?
I'm not
sure I understand.
Basically what it is, well, you know your green belt markers that you have? They have the green on it. It's something about that size. It can be identified and tagged as there's no disturbance beyond this point. And I can put some samples of together what has been used in the past to give to Maureen and see if that's acceptable.
Where would that go?
Basically, they're tagged onto the trees, and or if there aren't sufficient trees in the area, you can put a small iron post in place to secure it to.
Just one?
No, it'd be put along the perimeter at an interval so that people would recognize that there's a delineation along that setback line. Yeah, it'd have to be more than the one side.
Maureen, who would sort of supervise that being put in? I mean, to come up with a sufficient number that makes a difference.
Mr. Metcalf seems very familiar with this approach. I mean, he could put a plan together that would show, six markers along the boundary or whatever, and then it just becomes something we check, just like we check to make sure the trees are planted and the culverts are in.
There you go. Thanks.
Do the plans currently prohibit the alteration of the area outside the building envelope that is in the RP1?
In the open space here, or that portion of the lot?
That portion of the lot.
There's no language on the plan per se, but as I understand, that's part of your requirements within your 250-foot setback anyway. Additional language could be added to that plan if necessary, but I think from the site walk we were talking about at least being able to possibly delineate that edge.
Are any other comments or questions? David?
A couple of comments. I would go along with Barbara and her comments on the stop signs. I'd also recommend not requiring the owners to put a fence up, but I do think that the recommended arrangement for setback marking that Mr. Metcalf has stated would be favorable to me. I have a hard time moving into a town. I've been here 30 years, and the Jordan family's been here for history, and they're great stewards of property, and I don't like to. I feel uncomfortable asking them to do special things, especially after the amount of time and effort they've put to be good stewards in our town.
Barb.
Bob, are those little markers, they're not too costly, are they? Do they be a lot more efficient and less expensive than a fence?
They're definitely a lot.
Okay.
More cost effective than a fence.
All right. I'm bringing it up because I think we need to consider what the Conservation Commission said too, but do it in the most cost effective way we possibly can for the family.
Okay. Yeah, Paul. Bob, just so we're clear, it's referenced as both Hockey Pond Way and Hockey Pond Road in the documents we have, so I just want to make sure that it's consistent wherever and however.
Right. It's Hockey Pond Road. I had the way wrong. That was from the first one.
Thank you.
And just for what it's worth, I also echo David's comments. I think what we're looking towards is the day when perhaps it's a non-family member, somebody new that comes in perhaps to that lot would need to see it. And I agree that we should take the most reasonable approach here to that issue. Are there any other comments or questions for the applicant?
I would support the deletion of that stop sign, maybe both stop signs.
There are only eight houses.
The stop signs came at the recommendation of who?
Jim Williams.
The police chief. I mean, I would be reluctant to delete the stop sign at the end of Deer Run Road where it intersects with Spurwink. And I don't think that's overly burdensome to require of this applicant. Barbara?
I don't agree. I live in Cranbrook. There are 40-some-odd homes, and we don't have a stop sign when we go on to Mitchell. And to my knowledge, there's not been an accident there. I'm not going to say there never will be. I've just been corrected. I thought there were going to be eight homes, but there are only going to be five altogether. I just think that's a waste of money to ask them to do it, and I think it's totally unnecessary. Sorry to disagree.
Don't apologize.
I also have one other thing, and that is I thought we made an agreement that you would put six trees on the plans, but if any trees could be preserved in the right-of-way, that you could eliminate one for one. So we need to remember that I thought we made that agreement when we were out on the site.
I think we did.
We did, and I know that just when we looked at some of the location.
We need to. I mean, if you can save the three.
If we can save them, we will. Yeah.
In the current subdivision ordinance, it states under the requirement that requires trees that existing trees within the right-of-way, which have been preserved, may be counted toward this requirement if the species size preservation measures and post-construction condition of the trees are approved by the tree warden. So without a note on the plan, that's still an option.
Fine. Thank you.
I think the only real open area of disagreement is the stop signs. It might help us if we have a sense of where people come in that before we make a motion. Does anybody?
I see the need for one at Spurwink, but agreed. I don't see any reason to have an interior to this subdivision. But, and I know you don't have one there, but it couldn't hurt to have it, and it's not a lot of money.
All right, is there any further comments or discussion points? Anybody have a motion for the board to consider then? David?
Motion for the board to consider findings of fact that Jordan family is requesting a minor subdivision review of a three-lot subdivision located at the end of Deer Run Road, which requires review under section 16-2-3. Number two, the applicant is proposing a private road and retaining ownership to the private road, which provides vehicular access to the proposed lots as well as existing lots on Deer Run Road. Number three, Hockey Pond Road will require grading during construction that will require removal of most of the existing trees within the right-of-way. Number four, the applicant has substantially addressed the standards of the subdivision ordinance section 16-3-1. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and the material submitted, and the facts presented, the application of the Jordan family three-lot minor subdivision located at the end of Deer Run Road be approved subject to the following conditions. Number one, that a note be added to the plans expanding on the Q-RUB designation of the trees to include the full name of the trees, species, and size at time of planting. Number two, the deeds for conveying access rights to lots on Deer Run Road and Harkey Pond Road, a conservation deed for the open space and pedestrian rights deed for Lot 1 be submitted in the form acceptable to the town attorney and signed and recorded as needed. And three, that the plans be revised to reflect the above conditions and submitted to the town planner for review and approval prior to recording the subdivision plat.
Motion has been made.
I have two minor amendments that I'd like to propose, and then I'd like to second, and that is that the plans under number three should include a marker system to identify the RP1 no disturbance zone, as we discussed. And what I would like to add is that the developer only be required to install one stop sign at the the end of, is it Deer Run?
Deer Run Road.
And Spurwink. And with that amendment, I would second the motion.
I accept that amendment.
So motion has been made and seconded. Any further discussion? The only thing that I would point out is I believe condition one has already been satisfied. So as I'm not being all that clever, the town planner informed me of that. And we did have a discussion briefly a few minutes ago, so I would suggest that we take that off as a condition.
It's Dave's motion.
Dave, do you accept that?
I accept that.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor of the motion? It carries. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Final item on the agenda is Spurwink Woods LLC. They are requesting final subdivision review, a resource protection permit, and amendments to two previously approved subdivisions for Spurwink Woods, a 42-lot unit subdivision proposed for the area between Dermot Drive and Killdeer Road. The application includes 19 condominiums and 23 single-family home lots on 24.97 acres. The application will be reviewed for compliance with Section 16-2-4 subdivision regulations, Section 16-2-5 amendments to previously approved subdivisions, and Section 19-8-3 resource protection regulations. At this point, I would ask the applicant to step forward to the podium and summarize any changes to the project since our last meeting.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the Planning Board. My name is John Mitchell of Mitchell & Associates, and I represent Spurwink Woods, LLC. I would like to review with the board the plan changes since the last planning board meeting. I'd also would like to include in our presentation just a brief summary of our responses to Steve Harding's letter. Maureen McClone from Goro Palmer is here this evening just to give you a quick overview of the stormwater management plan, and hopefully Tom Gorrell will be here to give you an overview of the traffic, just an update on the traffic, and then just a few final comments. The plan changes since our last planning board meeting, the first one is the emergency gate. And as you know, throughout the design of this project, we have maintained not putting a gate in this development. And this was based on sound engineering and planning practices, opinions from two professional engineers, Tom Gorrell and the town's traffic engineer, Tom Errico, that cut-through traffic would not be significant for this project. And finally, an attempt to maintain the town's goal of connectivity, as outlined in Section 16-3-1 of the subdivision ordinance. We continue to hold this belief as professional planners and in engineers. However, in response to the discussions of the last planning board meeting, we have incorporated an emergency gate. And the revised plan set does show the emergency gate, and we have located it in the vicinity of Chicory Way in this location here. So all of the, all with the exception of one single family lot, will enter off of Spurwink Ave to access this portion of the development, and all the residents of the condominium project will enter off of Mitchell Road. The second change has been with regard to the individual property buffers. We have incorporated, we've added, actually we've added one additional hemlock in this area here. We've always had the hemlocks in back of the Darling and Valley property, but we have added one to supplement the ones that we originally had. We want to remind the board, and as evidenced during the site walk, that there is a significant amount of existing evergreen mature growth occurring from the edge of our property to the backs of the abutting homes. And on the Moran property, we added, on your plan set, you'll see we've added two red pines that have been planted in the site of the in the sight lines of approaching vehicles to help buffer the headlights heading in this direction here. I was given, this evening, I was given a quote from a landscape contractor for a significant increase of plant material in this area. We have two red pines, which we believe, as they mature in that location, will serve the purpose of buffering any headlights. This quote from a landscape contractor has 12 trees for this location, which I believe is a bit much to serve that purpose. The third change has been the revised open space plan. It was brought to our attention this past Friday that in addition to the 40% open space required under the open space zoning provisions of the ordinance, there is also a requirement for an open space impact fee. There was not time to address this item in our submission other than indicating that the applicant was willing to pay the impact fee for the additional 2 acres. However, we have prepared an amended plat plan that illustrates the revised limits of the open space, and you all have an 11x17 copy highlighting the revised open space limits. As outlined in Maureen's memo on pages 5 and 6, a total of 12.47 acres of open space is required. We have shown a total of 12.58 acres of open space, and we've incorporated part of the additional open space around the condo area so that the entire trail system is now within the public open space, and that area is shown here. With this in mind, we would recommend that the findings of fact, number 28 on page 14, read, the applicant will donate 12.58 acres of open space to the town in compliance with the open space zoning provisions. And the amount of $31,185 should be deleted. The next area item would be responses to Steve Harding's comments, and I believe that you have received a letter from Steve dated May 10th, 2006. And basically, Steve has signed off on this project. He had one comment, paragraph number 3, that pertained to the bituminous sidewalk cost estimate. That line item was inadvertently left off, but we've corrected that, and we've sent a copy to Steve and Maureen. The next item is stormwater management, and I'd like to ask Maureen McClone of Goro Palmer to give a quick overview of the stormwater. Thank you.
Hi there. I'm Maureen McClone with Goro Palmer. Goro Palmer had been responsible for the stormwater management since the last submission to the planning board. We have responded to comments by Ben Viola at the DEP, Steve Harding of OST, which is the peer reviewer for the town, as well as Chris Osterreiter from DeLuca Hoffman Associates. at the request of the DEP. For the most part, these comments have been reviewed and resulted in changes to the model, changes to the drawings, or both. With those comments, we provided formal response. You should have copies of those responses. As a result of those responses, we modified our stormwater management plan, and it's been sent to the DEP. You should also have a copy of that. Revisions to the plan as a result of comments, I'll hit the highlights, included relocating a level lip spreader, and that was down in this area over here. That level lip spreader was between, we relocated it between two lots at the request of Steve Harding at OST as well as the town for maintenance reasons. We've added under drains and some drainage stone to level lip spreaders. We have reviewed and revised the HydroCAD drainage model, stormwater model that we used, and as a result rerouted some flows and changed some of our areas. There are some instances where we have not revised our drawings based on comments, and those in general are lengths of T sub C path was a result of a comment from DeLuca Hoffman. Consistently, we've used a 150-foot flow path, and as it's professionally accepted flow path, and we, I guess, agree to disagree that we would use anything less than that, and certainly in the comment from DeLuca Hoffman, it indicated that a use of 150 feet would result in an understatement of the pre-peak flows, pre-development peak flows. We agree with that, so we're being conservative. We also have a table where we list the pre- and post-peak flows. In that table, because of the model inconsistencies, we've rounded to the nearest 1 CFS for any drainage areas that are over 1 acre, and to a half a CFS for any drainage areas less than an acre. We stick to that. There are no downstream impacts. We believe that there are no downstream impacts. In both of these cases where we disagree, we have the concurrence from Steve Harding at OST. So that pretty much hits the highlights. There have been very few changes that are on the surface, but we have changed the model to reflect some of the comments that folks have provided. If there are any other questions? And I guess I'll turn the next segment over to Tom Gorrell to discuss the traffic.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I'm Tom Gorrell with Gorrell Palmer. And as you know, we have been before you in the past, kind of urging connectivity. And that really is something we feel fairly strongly about. And we, the last time, had certainly recommended that the interconnectivity be maintained and that the project be monitored to see if there was an excessive amount of cut-through traffic, and if so, then a gate be installed. But the developer has been listening, and as a result, I guess, of the neighborhoods and all, have proposed the gate, which would be essentially east of Chicory Way. With that, obviously the potential for any cut-through traffic, which was one of the reasons that we were looking at a traffic calming program, is negated. There really wouldn't be any cut-through traffic. There will be 19 condominium units that would access through to Columbus, and one single-family home. Those 19 condos and one single-family home combined would generate 10 p.m. peak hour trip ends. So that's essentially, five in, five out. Obviously, during the peak hour, it's more like seven in and three out. But that's the amount of traffic you're looking at during a peak hour. The current traffic count on Columbus during a peak hour is 46. trip ends. So we'd be going from 46 to 57, obviously not a large increase. On Stevenson, there would be 22 single-family units. And those 22 units, since they're single-family units, would be generating about 22 trip ends. Again, that's during a peak hour, and that's in and outs combined. The existing trip ends on Stevenson is 25 during a p.m. peak hour, so we would be going from about 25 to 47 there with the 22 units. So with the I know that there was certainly talk about various traffic measures and such on Columbus for traffic calming, but it was really based, I guess, on these increases that it's our opinion that really traffic calming measures aren't really warranted as a result of this development in doing those fairly minor increases relatively. Again, the traffic calming program was primarily based upon trying to control cut-through traffic. And that's obviously done now with the gate, I guess. Relative to the intersection of Spurwink and Stevenson, we certainly continue to recommend that that be, to correct that existing sight line, be a three-way stop. We had talked about and we're recommending the flashing warning lights, which would be activated by the vehicle. They wouldn't flash all the time. They would be activated as the vehicle approached. You could, if you desired, not put those up initially and monitor it and see, you know, if monitor the compliance, and if the compliance was good, you wouldn't need it. But if it was felt that the compliance wasn't as good, then perhaps the flashers could go up at that time. So, again, we're, as a result of putting up the gate, we just think the cut-through traffic issue, the potential for that, the necessity for the traffic calming has gone away. So, thank you.
Thank you, Tom. In closing, I'd just like to take a minute to review with the board some of our key efforts that we have performed on this project. We have designed and redesigned the stormwater management plan twice. We have prepared two traffic reports, and the town engineer has concurred with both. Dale Brewer, a wetland specialist, has been out numerous times this spring to document that there are no vernal pools on the property. David Roque, the state soil scientist, has agreed with Dale. We've conducted two site visits with the planning board. We have held two neighborhood meetings. Steve Harding has signed off on all of the engineering-related comments. We believe we've addressed all of the comments that the planning board has asked of us, as well as several of the neighbors. And after this evening, there will have been two public hearings on this project. We have satisfied all of the requirements of the subdivision regulations, amendments to previously approved subdivisions, and the resource protection regulations. So on behalf of the applicant, we respectfully request that the board act on this final subdivision plan application this evening. Thank you.
Thank you. We have scheduled a public hearing for this evening, and I will open it up in just a few minutes. It looks like there's a decent number of folks who are coming here to speak tonight, and you all are welcome to do so. I would ask you each identify yourselves when you come to the podium, state your name and your residential address. To keep this moving along, since it is already 8 o'clock, I would just ask for a line to form behind the podium so that when one person finishes, the next person can begin, and we can try to avoid those dead spaces and do this efficiently. Also, I would ask the people here to refrain from applauding after a comment has been made. I understand there's a great deal of sentiment in the abutting neighborhoods, no kidding. But out of respect to the applicant, out of respect to the process, and out of respect to people who may be here to offer a different point of view. I would just ask that we stick to the comments, to the substance, and we are certainly ready to hear you out tonight. So without further ado, I will open up the public hearing.
Do we have a time limit?
That's a good question. I'm just hoping that people will be mindful of everyone's schedules, but there's not a strict limit. If it starts to take too long, then we'll discuss whether we need to impose one. And by the way, if somebody has already expressed your point of view eloquently, unlike I just did, you are welcome to get up and say, I agree with the comments of Mr. X, but here's my spin on it. Or you can just simply say, I agree with that person and sit down. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, my name is Julia Orr, and I live on 20 Chevres Road in Cape Elizabeth. The first thing I'm reading tonight is not something that I wrote. It's from some neighbors that live just down the road, and they asked if I could read it tonight because they were unable to be here, Ted and Allison Darling. Dear Planning Board, as I am unable to attend this evening's meeting, I've asked Julia to read my comments. As these are my comments, and I'm sure there's a time limit, please don't count this reading as Julia's time. I would like to thank the planning board, the developer and his crew, and all of the neighbors from the three neighborhoods for the time spent on the site walk on Saturday, May 6. In my estimation, this was time well spent. I would like to take this time to also reiterate my requests. These requests are also listed in the letter dated May 4, 2006, given to Marino Mera on the site walk and signed by my husband and myself and our neighbors, Rick and Sally Barker, Frank and Debbie Butterworth, Kathy Grork, Joe and Maureen Loring, Paul McGrath, and Jack and Debbie Vallalie, all direct abutters to South Street. As discussed on the site walk, I would like for mature evergreen, Fraser fir, Norway spruce, or Canadian hemlock trees be planted at the back of our property lines. And if the developer is willing, we would like him to plant evergreens in our backyards at the lawn line. The larger the tree, the better buffer from the start. Such evergreens being planted will help protect the root system of the existing trees and also work as means of protecting these trees on windy days. This should also work nicely for those trees the developer said would be remaining near our property lines. As there was some concerns discussion as to the protection of the taller established trees during the site walk, and this may work as a good remedy to a potential problem down the road. I would also like some sort of a guarantee that all existing trees on my property not be negatively affected by this project. If any trees are damaged, they should be replaced at the owner's request. We also discussed at the site walk the potential for having a stockade fence installed, preferably 8 feet tall, behind our homes. As I did learn on the site walk, the road elevation behind my home will not be all that drastic. Skip Murray said it would be 1 to 2 feet higher at the maximum. Behind some homes, the road elevation will in fact be 8 feet higher than the current landscape of the property. A fence would be most beneficial in preventing headlights from coming into our windows due to the curve of South Street and the placement of Franklin Circle. A fence will also help cut down on noise from the cars on South Street. Trash that will end up in our backyards during and after construction, pets that may wander off, and greater privacy for those residents on Macaulay Road and South Street. As you may recall, it was also discussed at the site walk the possibility of moving the location of the sidewalk. If the sidewalk could be moved from the area behind our homes and placed on the side of South Street where homes will exist, it might make more sense and have greater use. Otherwise, it makes little sense for homeowners and their children alike to cross the street to use a sidewalk that isn't even in front of any homes. It was pointed out at the sidewalk that the sidewalk would need to remain on the eastern side of South Street as it makes the turn into the development from Dermot Drive, but looks as though it could cross over after the ravine behind the Loring's property. There seemed to be some consensus that this could be done. This would also allow the abutters on Macaulay Road just a little more of a buffer behind our homes. We would also like an assurance that our foundations won't be affected by the blasting, and that if there are, they will be repaired at no cost to the homeowner. Any out-of-pocket expenses will be covered as well in order to remedy the situation.
It may take a few years to really know if there is water damage, as many of us have finished basements, and the determination as to potential water damage will be known only after truly soaking rains. This may take 12 to 18 months to determine this based on levels of precipitation. There's also the question of the gate. At the last planning board meeting, there was some discussion to not include the gate in this project and to let time decide if a gate is really deemed necessary in calming traffic through these existing neighborhoods. As three planning board members' terms expire in December 2006, I would think that it is imperative that the resolution to this issue occur while this collective board sits together. There will be no other time in this town's history that this issue will have the same players, planning board members, neighbors, and developers, trying to come to the resolution of such an important issue affecting so many families. If this is put off for another set of members, all of the work done on this issue will be for naught. Sincerely, Ted and Allison Darling, 35 Macaulay Road. So that was from them. Now this is from me. I am very emotionally distraught over this whole thing, I have to say. I don't know very much about water drainage or foundations or wetland protection. All I know is that this is a very, very beautiful piece of property, and my heart is totally tied up in this place. It's not my property. I don't own it. All I've done, though, is walk in there for 8 to 10 years and been very, very touched by this land, which I have come to love very deeply. I'm going to read a little story that I wrote about these woods. It's more of an emotional heart kind of piece, but it's important for me to read it. This is talking about the woods. This place takes you back to the memories of what was. A small girl driving in Scotland where the trees bent over, their limbs touching to form an arc as the sun streamed in. Conversations with the man you loved, but who was going down one path while you were going down another. Now this place takes me to what is. The impending reality that these woods may soon no longer exist, soon to be replaced by tidy condominiums with well-planned gardens. These trees that have stood there and been a witness to life for hundreds of years. Is there any way I can stand by these woods before the noise of bulldozers and the chainsaws fill the warm summer air? There's another place very different from these woods. To enter, you must be identified by the camera, which eyes you to see if you are an inmate or a mate that gets to go out at the end of the day. The wind strikes you hard during the winter months as you walk down the perimeter looking out at the fields and the trees before you're locked inside for the day. I work in the Maine State Prison. Choices have been made and choices have determined the fate of many. The choice to drive another time when you already had a stack of OUIs piled up on your desk like unpaid bills. You felt like you were able to handle the alcohol when you climbed onto your bike with your best friend sitting behind you, wanting to taste that freedom that had eluded you for so long. One more time with your best friend, no one would know. You crash and your best friend dies, and now everyone knows, particularly you. You have 20 years to think about why you decided to put that key in the ignition, 20 years to be in that same small space with that same small yard that looks out to traffic, fields, and forest. Between this yard and that space is a small bird that balances on the barbed wire with a piece of last year's grass in its beak. Or was it the choice to get the drug into your body the fastest, most effective way possible, because once it hit the bloodstream, the memories of what your father did begin to fade, and the sharp, twisted pain that you felt begins to melt, and you are left with nothing, but at the same time, everything, because for those moments, those thoughts, those feelings have subsided. But then addiction sets in, and in order to feed it, you had to sell the drug. The choice you made to keep your addiction satisfied has cost you 5 years in this place. You think about these women every day as you walk down the path where pine needles cushion your step. Your thoughts can weigh you down, and you want healing and peace for every person who's made a choice that has led to pain. The trees seem to have a knowing way about them. The energy from the pain of many feels as if it's slowly released to the universe as you walk, and the sun streams in through the trees and lights up the pale skin of the flowers. Choices have been made, though, and this place to walk and sort out thoughts may soon become a place where the machine comes in and takes down the dreams of many. Thank you.
Thank you. I actually I'm just going to apologize in advance. I do have to leave my cell phone on, but I have it on vibrate. But if anybody else has cell phones, if you could just try to make sure they're off or on the vibrate setting, that would be helpful for the people making comments. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. My name is Claudia Drico. I live at 70 Columbus Road. I understand that the planning board members are not permitted to discuss projects currently before the board outside of a planning board meeting or workshop. I just want to note that the frustration you have been hearing from me and others is from the fact that many of the issues that have been raised repeatedly over the last 6 months were not being discussed or even acknowledged at planning board meetings. In addition, repeated requests for more public hearings or public comment at planning board meetings were denied, although the chair has the discretion to grant them. At one meeting, the town planner misinformed the board members and the public, saying that allowing public comment outside of a scheduled public hearing was at the discretion of the applicants. The applicants, of course, chose not to allow it. The planning board just began to address some of the outstanding issues at the most recent planning board meeting in April. Still, I feel there has not been adequate resolution to a number of issues or adequate response to questions asked. As far as traffic calming measures go, the applicants have placed a gate on their plan, but in the event the town does not approve the gate, or the planning board does not approve the gate, there appears to be no consensus between Goral Palmer and members of the planning board on the effectiveness of the traffic calming measures that are being considered. In addition, the developers have made it clear that they do not want to install sidewalks on Columbus Road, and made every effort to scare the Columbus Road residents away from that option by showing them how much of their front yards they would lose with a 5-foot sidewalk and 5-foot esplanade. Of course, neither one needs to be as wide as 5 feet. The possibility of a gate is still outstanding. Obviously, traffic calming issues still need to be resolved. Buffers. It should be specified and required that buffers to all the abutting properties be treed and not clear cut, as in the case of Blueberry Ridge and some of the properties in Cross Hill that abut Layton Farms. This is a concern, especially for the properties where the walking trail runs right along property lines. Cluster housing. I guess, from what I gathered, the applicant's plan, initial plan was for 30% open space, but they've just amended it to 40%, is that correct? No, tonight the increase of 2 acres to the open space.
I'm not sure the percentages are correct.
The original proposal.
40 to 50?
Yeah, the original proposal was 40%, and they've increased it by an additional 2 acres.
Okay. I still have not heard a rational argument for cluster housing in this particular environment. I know cluster housing is the planning buzzword of the moment, but it must make sense within the natural environment for it to be effective. The objective of cluster housing is to preserve the natural environment by retaining more open space than a conventional development. In the case of Spurwink Woods, however, approximately 15 acres of old-growth pine forest habitat will be destroyed, a habitat that could be largely saved in a more thoughtful conventional plan. At the March and April planning board meetings, there was more discussion about saving trees on one lot on Avon Road than there has been on the loss of irreplaceable significant woodlands in Spurwink Woods. The town planner has stated that a conventional housing plan would offer less open space. That may be true for certain landscapes. However, the proposed open space in Spurwink Woods consists largely of scrubby knolls of bedrock and 5 acres of RP1 and 2 wetlands, an area not developable due to wetland building regulations, an area that would continue to be open space because of these regulations in any housing plan. Conventional development does not preclude contiguous open space and walking trails. The argument that homeowners could clear-cut their lots if so desired does not hold water. A no-cut treed buffer of any size could be created between lots and established easily in a subdivision's covenants, thus preserving as much of the natural habitat as possible. The planning board only has to make these things a condition of development. Cluster housing should be implemented in order to preserve the natural environment. That is its objective. Perhaps a forested habitat bordered by wetlands is not the correct landscape in which to implement cluster housing. I know the planning board asked the applicants to come up with a cluster plan after viewing their initial conventional development submission, But when it becomes obvious that the plan does not adequately meet its objective, the planning board should have the guts to stop it and pursue a different direction. It's not too late to start over. Cape Elizabeth does not need more residential housing. Although the town manager claims that school enrollment is expected to decline, if you continue to build houses, families will continue to move to Cape Elizabeth based on the reputation of its schools. Senior citizens do not move to Cape Elizabeth. The reality is that our schools cannot physically handle the increased enrollments, and as judged by the outcome of last night's town council meeting, the town is not willing to pay the full cost of educating additional students. In the comprehensive plan survey of last fall, 8 in 10 residents indicated that protecting and preserving wetlands, ponds, and wooded areas, and preserving the town's rural character should be the most important goals for the town over the next 5 to 10 years. In light of that, instead of approving more residential housing, the planning board should be working closely with the land trust to find grant and subsidy opportunities to protect these areas from development. Thank you for your time and consideration.
Thank you.
Mr. Sherman and members of the planning board, my name is Paul Katsos. I live at 33 Columbus Road. I'd like to thank you all for coming to not one but two site visits. As I'm sure you all noticed when you visited last Saturday, Mitchell Highlands, the neighborhood off Columbus, is a relatively small neighborhood of about 50 homes, the farthest point being about 0.3 miles from Mitchell Road. Chicory Way, or the proposed Chicory Way, is nothing which the residents of Mitchell Highlands... Would you like a minute? Yeah. Or some paper towels?
Well, like, we'll get some paper towels. You know, okay. Okay, go ahead.
Sure. The proposed Chicory Way isn't anything which we in Mitchell Highlands want or we've ever asked for. It's something that was placed on the plan so that the developers could comply with certain regulations. Now, I understand Mr. Mitchell's comments that they've been before you with many changes to the plans, but the discussion of a gate and where to place a gate has only been developed since the second neighborhood meeting, at the urging of the neighbors that a gate be put in place. So there's been limited discussion amongst you as to what's the most appropriate gate. And since the time of that second neighborhood meeting, it's come to light that there are plans, perhaps not firm, but plans to develop the adjacent parcel, which would add additional cut-through traffic through the very area on Chicory Way, which will lead into Mitchell Highlands. I ask you as planning board members if you can truly say how many cars will be introduced to Mitchell Highlands by that further development, let alone the development, which with projections of about 10 cars per house, there's already 200 cars per day being added to Mitchell Highlands before any adjacent properties are developed. The solution for the traffic problem in Mitchell Highlands is not to make a problem at all. If Chicory Way must be built for emergency access, we ask that you build it only for emergency access and place a gate on Chicory Way. While we'll continue to ask the rest of the voters in the town of Cape Elizabeth to either get absentee ballots or come to the polls on June 13 and vote yes for the referendum to protect our neighborhoods, we ask that you act now and look forward towards putting a gate on Chicory Way. If traffic engineers are able to accurately calculate the amount of traffic which will be projected from new roads which don't even exist, certainly those same engineers can come up with a way to make a gate which meets the needs of the emergency personnel in Cape Elizabeth, which can be operated when they need to for emergency purposes only. And building a gate that allows for bicycle or pedestrian traffic around will truly allow for neighborhood connectivity as opposed to merely subjecting Mitchell Highlands to vehicle traffic. I'd ask you to balance Spurwink Woods' interest in making profits with the interests of those adjacent neighbors, their property rights, and the rights to maintain the neighborhoods which they've enjoyed when you make your decisions with regard to how to limit traffic. And I'd ask you to strongly consider moving the gate to Chicory Way.
Thank you.
Lyndon Keck, 42 Columbus Road. My wife is sick this evening, and so I did a yes, dear, as I left the house. She said, make sure the board understands that I still oppose the project. There you go, Holly. Holly Hoffman and I are residents at 42 Columbus Road and will be negatively impacted by the proposed Spurwink Woods division. We have spoken on several occasions to the board as well as the council, and we've written many letters to the planning board. To date, we have received no written response to any of the questions that we have asked. I would like to reiterate some of our most important objections to the project. The first is that we believe it is not and does not represent sound planning principles. Section 16-1-1 of the subdivision ordinance promotes development that fits harmoniously into the existing natural environment and rural character. Number two, usable open space. We do not believe that the usable open space as designated by the developer satisfies the requirements of Article 3, Section 16-3-1, which states that multiplex housing and cluster developments shall be so designed, sited, and laid out as to minimize disturbance of existing topography, ground cover, and to provide maximum usable, natural, or improved open space, and shall be compatible with any surrounding land use and their character. Three, we believe that the applicant's application has an unacceptable storm management plan that will not guarantee that post-development runoff will be less than pre-development runoff. Stormwater plans in conformance with Cape Elizabeth ordinances and the Maine Department of Environmental Protection almost always have two components to them, as I've explained previously. The first is the control of stormwater quantity. The second is measures to control and improve the water quality. This site's watershed empties into and is part of a larger Trout Brook watershed that has been identified by the state of Maine as an urban impaired waterway that requires development within this area to show special sensitivity to both quality of water and quantity of water. As I've stated in the past, Holly and I believe there are two obvious flaws and questions that we've asked the developer and we've asked the board and to which we've received no response. The first is, how does frozen ground absorb water? Winter conditions in Maine result in frozen ground between November and April. The recent rains in January of 2006, February 2006, and the last 10 days have resulted in substantial flooding throughout southern Maine. The second question we've asked and we have not received an answer to is, how does rock absorb water? As we've stated in the past, this site has substantial quantities of ledge outcropping and probably has soils that are shallow to bedrock. We have previously requested the planning board require a high-intensity soil survey. We have not seen such a submission from the applicant. If the developer is going to be allowed to let water flow directly into the wetland areas without containment, at a minimum, we believe the planning board should require a hydrologic study to provide the planning board with an engineering opinion as to the soil absorption rates, depth to ledge, and an explanation to the two questions that we've asked above. At a minimum, the developer should be required to provide the board with test pits or borings prepared by a certified geologist that will support the notion that the soils on this particular site can absorb the quantities of water that Goral Palmer is suggesting in their stormwater plan. To date, I've seen no test pit results and no boring results. Goral Palmer and their stormwater management plan, which was resubmitted and revised on April 28th, clearly states on page 3, and I quote, "The capabilities of the computer model are limited when using buffer strips. The available modeling does not account for the attenuation of overland flow through a buffer strip after a level lip spreader," end quote.
I believe the board has a duty to insist on answers to the questions and to insist on a real field results survey that shows the quality of the soils and the depth to bedrock. And I believe this should be done before final approval is granted to the project. Fourth objection. We believe the trail system is impractical. The board should be aware that the proposed trail system is directly downstream from level lip spreaders 1 and 2. Goro Palmer should explain why the proposed trail system will not be inundated underwater with large quantities of stormwater that will be released by the level lip spreaders. In addition, the level lip spreader is only 18 inches deep, and frost in our area runs between 4 and 5 feet. I believe the level lip spreader will fail, and it will not remain level with the present design. The water has to pass over the trail system on its way to the RP2 wetland. In addition to the level lip spreaders, this project also dumps uncontrolled stormwater directly onto the ground with no detention and no level lip spreader technology in the following locations: the termination of catch basin number 4, catch basin number 21B, and catch basin number 23. Fifth objection, neighborhood density. Holly and I have consistently stated that this project is much too large and is much too dense. The new house lots are generally smaller than 1/5 of an acre, yet surrounding neighborhoods have house lots that vary from 1/3 of an acre to over 1 acre. The subdivision ordinance specifically states that a project should be, quote, compatible with the surrounding neighborhoods, and a development should fit harmoniously into the existing natural environment and the rural character, end quote. We do not believe that house lots that are 1/5 of an acre comply with the definition of rural character and are not compatible with the adjacent neighborhoods where house lots are 200% to 400% larger. Next objection. The project does not fit into the existing natural environment. The condominium portion of the project will require complete clear cutting and will involve a clear area which is 900 feet long and 280 feet wide. My review of the areas affected by construction show that 231,000 square feet of forest land will have to be completely clear cut and removed. This is the equivalent of 4 football fields. If the density on this project were lower, the project could be designed with smaller clusters of 4 to 5 units. These would be less disruptive on the topography, the natural environment, and the natural forest, which all of the neighborhood believes is very special. Next objection. Holly and I believe there's a conflict with lot number 11. It's an existing house lot as part of another subdivision that is now being made into a substandard lot. This is a dangerous precedent for Cape Elizabeth. This is not a new lot. This is not a new dwelling, and it should be preserved under the 20,000 square foot minimum lot area requirement for the Residence C district. And our last objection is traffic. Our primary objection to this project all along, as presently designed, is that it converts 2 quiet dead-end neighborhoods into through traffic shortcut neighborhoods. After months of stating our position about quiet dead-end neighborhoods and defensible space, a gate is finally being discussed. We understand that a gate is not automatically going to be approved by the planning board, and further, the gate would have to be accepted by the town council. Holly and I believe that we have to assume that the gate will not ultimately prevail and that our quiet dead-end neighborhood will be destroyed. Loop roads and dead-end streets create defensible space that results in slower traffic, quieter and safer environments where children can play with little fear of fast-moving shortcut traffic. Loop roads and dead-end streets encourage and promote familiarity and social neighboring between houses. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Dear planning board members, I'm Sharon O'Neill. I live at 56 Columbus Road. And I'd like to address three items regarding the proposed Spurwink Woods development. My first issue surrounds the conversion of the Killdeer lot into an access road. This portion of the plan has disturbed me from the beginning and prompted the petition drive to limit shortcuts. The design of the Mitchell Highlands development implies that the lots would be used for residential use only. It is also our understanding that the developer has access to property on Spurwink Road that could be used to create a loop road. It would have eliminated the need for such a conversion. We ask that the conversion of the Killdeer lot into an access road not be approved. Second is the installation of an emergency-only access gate. And this remains our first choice to prevent cut-through traffic, and we're pleased it's being considered. We do, however, have three issues regarding the gate. There's been considerable discussion of the Maxwell family developing their land in the not-too-distant future. To plan for future development, we request that language be put in place which grants an easement off Chicory Way where a gate can be relocated. With the many concerns raised about a gate's effectiveness, we hope to see a gate installed that will actually work in an emergency. We would be as disappointed as town staff to see a chain draped across two poles with a lock on it. We are positive that a solution can be reached which prevents the cut-through traffic while allowing emergency vehicles easy access to and from the property. Lastly is the placement of the gate, although I don't really have any issue with that. I think it seems like a fair compromise. Although it does lead into our only last issue, which is the installation of sidewalks with esplanades. And I reiterate what Claudia says, there's a lot of uncertainty about whether the gate will be approved or not at this level or at the town council level when they go to review the roads and approve the roads. So my last really leads into the installation of the sidewalks with esplanades. And this remains our second choice. It was also the second choice of many of our neighbors until the May 6th site walk. The site walk was informative, and I will reiterate, we truly appreciate the planning board taking the time to meet with us on Saturday. It did, however, give the developers an opportunity to scare neighbors away from sidewalks by threatening to take away half of their lawns. It was our impression the site walk was intended to review traffic calming measures in our neighborhood. We did not think it was intended to give developers yet another opportunity to tell the abutters they have no desire to install preferable traffic calming measures in their neighborhoods. If the traffic generated from 19 condos is going to be added, traffic which does not currently travel through our neighborhood, serious consideration, in addition to the fact of whether the gate will be installed or not, needs to be given to some type of sidewalk. Whether it be blacktop or concrete, we are confident that it can be constructed in a way which maintains the current landscape and character of Columbus Road. The sidewalks on Hamlin Street are a perfect example of how they can be added without being intrusive. We understand the developer does not want to install sidewalks because they are costly. There are, however, millions of dollars to be made on this project. Making concessions to abutters, whether it be sidewalks or buffers, is the price one pays for developing the land. We realize this has been a long process, and we thank the planning board for their time.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Carol Ann Olson, and I live at 33 Thrasher Road. I'd like to share some observations with you and then ask 2 points of information. The first observation is that my dog and I walk at least once, maybe twice a day, the loop of Thrasher, Killdeer, Columbus. And we have noticed an increase in people coming from outside our neighborhood to walk their dogs as well. When I'm walking my dog and I'm listening to books on tape or something, I tend not to walk directly on the side of the road. I tend to walk sort of in the middle so that my dog will stay off other people's lawns. If there is no sidewalk there, and if we have increased traffic that is coming down through there, I'm worried about those people who are listening to things and who don't hear traffic coming down the road. And I guess that leads to my point of information. Are sidewalks still on the table with the planning board, or are they not being considered?
They're still on the table.
They still are on the table. Thank you. And my second observation is that when I moved into my house in 2001, my land abuts protected wetlands. I was told this when I moved in, that I could not do anything to it because these wetlands were protected. I have also been told by my neighbors that these wetlands are increasing every year. And Mr. Keck alluded to the stormwater runoff, and that too has my attention. And the reason it has my attention is that my sump pump is going off every 61 seconds. And I have the water runoff from the killdeer on down. So I guess my question is, I know everybody's intentions are good, but we have only to see the events of the last week or so this is my point of information. What happens if something fails and the water doesn't go where we want it to? What happens to the abutting neighbors whose lands become more and more unimprovable because of increased water and the rise of wetlands?
Well, I think we can discuss the issue of stormwater management when we begin the substantive review, but we'll certainly take your comments into account.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, Dick Moran, 38 Killdeer Road. One correction, the proposal for the buffer on my property was 2 trees, not 12. I don't know if a 1 got next to a 2 someplace. It's 2 trees, and there's actually 2 proposals. The other one was 5, like, shrubs, kind of in a semicircle, and they're both about the same price. I prefer the shrubs. I can manage them better, trim them, carve them, stuff like that. There's a couple of issues that I'm uncomfortable with, and it's the intersections that this project's going to live and breathe on. I don't think there's any clear, at least I haven't heard of any clear direction on what you want to do with these intersections. There's been proposals of flashing lights, stop signs, and I just hope the council is comfortable in what they decide is going to be the answer, because there are bus stops at these intersections. I've been leaving Columbus Road several times a day for 15 years, and every time I go, it's the minute you commit, somebody comes over the hill, and I experience 1 to 2 near misses a week. And in the winter, when you don't have as much traction, you kind of get hung up. So now you're in the middle of the road with someone coming over, and it's even more dangerous. There's a bus stop right there, so you really have to take that into consideration. Some of it's line of sight, but my opinion, it's that hill. If they're coming up over the hill at the speed limit, it's not bad. If they're speeding, it's a close call. I deal with that several times a day. So the intersections, I think you really have to be comfortable in what you approve. And you've heard all the other issues, the decreased home values. I have a concern with the construction traffic. 5 to 7 years is a long time to listen to this, and I don't know if there's any other way around it. I would have liked to have seen a construction entrance. I know there's a lot next to Spurwink with RP1. You know, if a bridge has to be built, I mean, you could say, you know, on your sidewalk on my corner, you saw how small that was, and you saw where that road's going in. You can just imagine the trucks, the sound of the trucks, and just trying to maneuver around the cars going in and out of that. I don't know if it's unacceptable or unfair, but it's really an inconvenience big time for all the residents. Once you get framing those houses, you have the framers, you have the lumber deliveries, electricians, plumbers, heaters coming in and out. Guys go for supplies throughout the day. And you may laugh, but coffee breaks create a lot of traffic. Everybody goes to the store a few times a day. When you have a crew of framers, you know, with just seven vehicles, just imagine, you know, that times, I don't know, 2 or 3 houses at a time, whatever they're going to build. So there's going to be a lot of construction traffic, a lot. This Maxwell property, if you want to put that on the fast track, you know, you could get that road in there, and that could be a loop road and eliminate most of our concerns. So I was glad to hear that some of you at the last meeting said that connectivity, sometimes it has a place and sometimes it doesn't. I don't think this is a project where it has a place. So I heard at one point in our subdivision ordinance that if a subdivision has a negative effect on abutting properties, it won't be approved. If you take a look how narrow my street is, and you look at all the traffic going through there, I don't see any positive effect out of that, or for any of my neighbors. And I guess that's about it. And I concur with everything else that's been said. You've heard it in our emails. And so thank you for your time.
Thank you.
My name's Richard Bryant, or Nick Bryant. I live at 55 Sperwink Avenue. First off, I also want to thank the board for all the time you put in on this project. I know the site walks take a lot of time, and all these meetings take time, and reading all our voluminous emails and correspondence, I'm sure, takes time as well. We're very pleased that the board has encouraged the applicant to put in a proposed limited access gate, because that does address the most obvious adverse effect of traffic that results from this development. However, there are a number of other issues that I think you need to address in your consideration of final approval, and I'll go down and try to condense them as much as I can here. First ones have to do with the access gate. It seems to me the reason that there's such resistance on the town staff to limited access gates is because they're not used. And if you have a gate that is used consistently and has an access system that doesn't require somebody to get out and open a key in the middle of a storm, that's going to make sure that gate functions when it's needed as well as the rest of the time. So a gate system that includes either a radio remote control, a keypad entry, or a card entry with that code or those cards distributed to the police, to the volunteer fire folks, to the plow folks, that will assure, and if we have regular police beats that drive through that gate and use that gate, that will assure that if there's any kind of maintenance issue, it will be noticed right away and taken care of. So that will mean the gate will be ready for emergency access when an emergency occurs. And I also think that you should require, with respect to the gate, you should require before final approval that you get input from the public works and the fire chief and the police chief as to that gate system and what works best for them. Secondly, is the gate location. Paul Katzo suggested there's an issue about where that gate goes. I happen to think that the location currently proposed, which is essentially splits this project in half, is the most sensible compromise position. And it means you don't have to add an extra backup lane, because you can use Chicory Way for one side. There will be a Chicory Way for one side, and there'll be a small turnout near the trail crossing for the other. However, you ought to plan for what's going to happen next. And what's going to happen next is Maxwell's property is going to be developed. You've amended the bisected lots ordinance, so this road at South Street is extended here to the Maxwell property. When this property gets developed, you're going to have exactly the same issue again, and you should anticipate that. I think what is probably the best solution at that time is to provide that this access gate here be moved to Chicory Way at that point. That means you have a loop road here, so no cut-through traffic. You have a gate here that prevents Mitchell Highlands from being affected by the traffic on the west side of the gate, or north side of the gate. To do that, you should make sure that the plan includes a reservation of easements, either at lot 11 or lot 10 here, so that there's a place for a turnaround as necessary. So when this gets developed, the gate can be moved to here, and there'll be a built-in turnaround. You won't have a problem about putting in another turnaround lane, as you have currently proposed here. Similar kind of location, except somewhere on Chicory Way. Second issue, South Street. The developer's attorney and the developer's engineer and the developer have all said, we can't do anything to improve South Street because we don't have the right to do it. They should either prove that's the case, and if they're right, which I don't think they are, you should not allow them to develop any part of the private way of South Street here, which is why I think they can't prove it. If it's not true, you should require the developer to improve South Street. Sooner or later, that street is going to have to be improved. You should do it now when they're putting, essentially going to be doubling the traffic that comes in through this existing neighborhood. Now is the time to do it. The traffic is caused by their development. They should pay for it. Spurwink and Stevenson, that intersection, because I live right at the intersection, that's near and dear to my heart. So my comments on that are that I think you should not make any changes to that intersection until we see if they're needed. And if indeed this traffic, it does not create it, that the gate goes in and there's relatively limited development here, you may not need to do much to that intersection. The first thing that you should consider doing is either a one-way stop sign for the northbound traffic on Spurwink. So the traffic that's coming around the corner from 77 will stop, and that's the only traffic that the traffic coming southbound on Spurwink, turning into Stevenson, has to worry about. That's the only sight line that's affected by that corner. A three-way stop just causes annoyance to everybody around because of the stopping and starting of cars, and you should only stop the traffic when it's necessary. An alternative to that might be some kind of warning device, well, actually, maybe a supplement to that, is maybe a warning device which alerts traffic, southbound traffic on Spurwink, that my driveway is being used, because my driveway is immediately after the curve, and you can't see it. So either some device that we can light a sign or light a light on the blind driveway sign that's on Spurwink, lets people know it's being used, or conversely, something that detects traffic coming up Spurwink that we can see from our driveway to know there's traffic coming around the corner. Again, we've lived there 13 years, have had one accident. We're just very careful, but as we get more and more traffic there, that might become necessary down the line. Only after you've considered those things should you look at things like a warning sign or a stop sign for northbound traffic that might be activated by a motion detector device that detects southbound Spurwink traffic. So traffic coming up the hill, when it's detected, there'll be some kind of device that alerts northbound traffic, careful, there's cars coming up that may turn in front of you. Alternatively, you can have a device for southbound traffic on Spurwink that says, wait, there's traffic coming around the corner, don't turn here. I don't know which of those works. I asked Girl Palmer to give me some feedback on whether those were practical or not. I haven't heard anything yet, but the board ought to ask that question, whether those are possible. The last solution ought to be a three-way stop sign or a stoplight there. I think that's the worst solution of all. And finally, whatever stop sign is put there, you should require the developer to also buffer the properties that are most immediately affected by that with a hedge or something if that homeowner wants it. Construction traffic. There's going to be a lot of heavy traffic. It's going to go through existing residential streets, have lots of kids on them. You saw the kids out there in the Mitchell Highlands. There's been no analysis of that from the developer or the developer's engineers. They just said, yes, there's going to be traffic. The only thing they've suggested is we'll have a guy with a flag out there when the big trucks are going to move the big equipment in at either Spurwink and Stevenson or Mitchell and Columbus. You should have the developer produce some kind of plan that limits the traffic or decides where it's going to be routed so that that takes into account school bus stops and the time kids are likely to be out there, and to have the developer limit that.
Before you go to the next point, I'm just wondering, how many more people are planning to speak? One, two, three. Okay, you've been going for about 10 minutes. I'm looking collectively at the entire group. It doesn't seem like this is going too long, but since there are about four or five more folks, if you could...
I will speed up.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Density open space and tree preservation. I second Ms. Drico's position, which says that if you can, that you can actually achieve more effective open space by having a traditional subdivision design that's less dense. You can require larger lots to have smaller building envelopes and have no-cut zones with buffers, put the trails through there. You will decrease the density. You will get more effective open space than you get in this plan. And secondly, the board really should require the developer, as the ordinance sets forth at 16310, or 16310 letter O, to identify the major trees on this property. All they've said when we've asked that is, golly gee, there's a lot of open space there, so whatever's on the open space will be preserved. That doesn't tell you what they're clear-cutting. And all of these lots here, because of their size, are going to be clear-cut to be able to put a house on those size lots. So you have to know what's there to be preserved before you can properly plan to make allowance for preservation of trees. Scenic views and a comprehensive plan. The plan should require that none of this development up here should be any higher than the existing preserved tree lines. The comprehensive plan talks about making sure you preserve scenic views from, and that would include the view across that open wetland as you're driving down Spurwink. I second Mr. Keck's comments with regard to stormwater. I think the town should require quality as well as quantity planning, and that the board should not allow the developer to try to grandfather their plan under the old DEP rules, but to use the current DEP rules. Mitchell Highlands amendment, I still think it's inconsistent with the existing Mitchell Highlands plan to convert an existing residential house lot into a throughway. And it clearly wasn't intended for, especially for a loop road like Killdeer, to have traffic come through there. For that lot, which is lot 11 on your plan as well, that's designated as an affordable housing lot. The affordable housing ordinance requires affordable housing to be consistent with the rest of the new development. And I don't think making a 30 or 40 year old house is acceptable as affordable housing because it doesn't meet the standards under the affordable housing ordinance. Lastly, the final plan should not allow the condominium to increase the number of units or alter the location of the units without getting planning board approval. Right now, the condominium declaration has a provision that allows declaration of a number of other units, and that should be stated on the plan. They can't do that without coming back to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, planning board members, my name is Paul LaLiberty. Ann and I have lived at 29 Thrasher Road for 32 years. Mitchell Highlands has been a very part of our life, raising our children. We would very much hate to see that change. We think that the size of Mitchell Highlands and the Spurwink Woods project are about comparable, and that Mitchell Highlands should not receive any additional traffic. We would suggest, as Mr. Costos had indicated, that a gate be installed and installed on Chicory Way. A condition of the plan may be when the future Maxwell property is developed to convert Chicory Way to a walking path and the gate be removed so that we could have connectivity between the two neighborhoods via walking paths rather than cut through traffic or even from those developments. Thank you for the opportunity to speak.
Thank you. Sir, before you leave, you made a comment during the site walk about stop sign location.
Yes.
I don't know if that's been on the record yet. Would you mind addressing that issue?
Evidently we have, excuse me, we have so many options as to what is going to happen. Should a gate not be installed and traffic calming measures be installed on Columbus Road, really wish you'd consider the fact that it does not prevent or does not change the traffic flow from Columbus onto Killdeer and Thrasher. Those are narrow streets as compared to Columbus, although we are trying to reduce the size of Columbus for traffic calming measures. But looking at the whole Figure 8 neighborhood, that it is equally proportioned for traffic.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Larry Stern. I live at 1 Columbus Road, right at the corner of Columbus and Mitchell. I'm not going to try to just repeat many of the things that my neighbors have said more articulately than I could hope to, except to say that I heartily concur with what Claudia Drico said about the cluster development, that it's a good planning tool sometimes, but in this case, especially after the site walk, I have some doubts whether it makes sense in that particular area given the density of the development that's planned. I want to talk just for a minute, though, about two good things that have come out of this process. Nobody said much good about it, I guess, but one thing is I think my wife and I think probably some of the rest of us have gotten a deeper appreciation for what you folks do in terms of volunteering your time up here. You spend a huge amount of time up here listening to people, many of whom are not in a particularly good mood when they do it. You have to read through many emails, some of which probably take you to task in perhaps rather harsh ways. And I just want to personally thank you all for the time you put into this. I know it's not an easy job, and I think you really deserve credit for all you do. The other part of the process that I think is good on here is that I, who have lived on Columbus Road for 4 years now, have met many neighbors that I didn't know before. In part through this, we've come together and met and gotten together. Part of the reason, though, that that's happened, I think, is because of what I see, at least, as maybe a process that needs to be looked at more carefully in the future. I think I've been very impressed by not only how bright and articulate many of my neighbors are, but basically good, gentle souls, but people who have gotten very upset, sometimes irate, in ways that surprised me over this process. And I think we have to ask why that's happened. Obviously, whenever something happens in our backyards, we all tend to get upset, as I'm sure you all would if this was in your backyard. That's a natural thing. But it seems like it's been more than necessary, and I have to ask why. And I think the feeling is, among many of us, and I include myself in this group, is that we felt that, rightly or wrongly, that the process was shaped more than perhaps necessary. Every town has a vision. Every town has a vision of what they want, whether it's connectivity or something else at the beginning, but that was almost managed too much. And I think many of us, rightly or wrongly, felt shut out or not included enough in the early process of this. I know that you're constrained as a planning board in some ways, but I wonder whether there isn't some room to change the process in some way that would have made this less of an antagonistic process than it turned out to be. I know I personally felt that with my own issue at One Columbus, that a preliminary approval was given for a plan that could have made massive changes at my corner without ever having an opportunity to come before you and speak about that. But I think many of the rest of us felt that same way about the development as a whole, that somehow or other it felt that the process needed to be opened up more than it was. I think what you've seen here, though, is a great demonstration of democracy. Neighbors have risen up, they've gotten together, neighbors who didn't know each other, and they've really spoken with one voice to a large degree about what we want. And I got the sense at the site visit, I got the sense from listening to you at the last meeting that you did hear some of that, and I thank you for that. Clearly, the neighborhood wants a gate in the area. They're trying to work with the planning board, but I think clearly we've spoken as a strong force in a democratic process for this kind of a solution to the problem. And I hope you do listen to the neighbors, and I thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. Dominic Tracy. I live at 5 Phillip Road. I have previously lived on Chevres Road, however. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to talk tonight, and I realize we're pressed for time, so I won't, you know, go on about the traffic, stormwater runoff, vernal pools, all of the open issues that everybody else has addressed. I really don't have a whole lot of time to you know, follow this stuff, get involved, you know, as a father, full-time worker. It's not something that I can devote a whole lot of attention to, so really all I can do is just provide some observations from you know, what I've seen as a Cape resident of this process. And in particular, I'd like to just make some observations about our town planner, who you know, clearly this project was a done deal, like before it was even, you know, brought into the public eye. And I guess what I find interesting is just during the public comment periods, she's clearly like not even listening. You know, she's heads down. And I guess, I mean, I find that not only unprofessional, but just...
Excuse me.
Yeah,
I'm
sorry, but this is not a time to attack you.
Okay, I'm just...
Sorry.
Okay.
I would echo that.
And, sir...
Excuse me.
I appreciate you speaking to the merits of the application to the extent that
it was just a public comment.
Well,
I'm speaking to the process.
Okay. To the merits of the project and not to any personality, whether it's the town planner or any member of this board.
I was getting into the...
Your comments are entirely inappropriate.
I'm speaking to the process by which this project was brought before the town.
Not at all. You aren't, and I would suggest to the chair that if the comments go in this direction, that the gentleman be excused and we move on with the process.
Well sir, you've sort of heard where we're coming from. If you could temper your comments and try to depersonalize them, we would most appreciate it.
Okay. I was just going to make a comment that in the last session that I came to, where public comments were accepted, the comment was made that this project or in general this board approves 20 building permits per year, and this project meets this quota for 2 years or something like that, and I wasn't really aware that you know that the town has this quota that we have to meet of rushing out these building permits. And it makes me, you know, wonder, you know, how long is this going to go on? We only have a finite amount of space in the town of Cape Elizabeth. And, you know, when it's all filled up, are we going to, you know, raise an army and invade Scarborough? I think that we need to, you know, begin looking at you know, we have a finite amount of space in this town. And when you go and you look at the amount, the scale, the scope of that project that they're talking about putting into that particular place, clearly we have a disconnect between what the majority of residents of this town are feeling is appropriate and what the members of the planning board are also seeing as appropriate. And so I guess I would just ask that the planning board, perhaps when you know you guys get back behind closed doors, to maybe do some introspection and you know about this disconnect that really seems to be going on. I mean, there's a lot of passion that you guys are seeing. You know, we kind of feel like we've been sort of hoodwinked, I guess, to a certain degree. You know, where is that disconnect rooted, and you know, perhaps some introspection on the part of the planning board would be appropriate. And thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Fernald.
Good evening. Just like to start off, particularly I meant one. Oh,
I know
I'm sorry.
Who you are, but could you...
Becky Fernald, I live at 313 Mitchell Road.
Thank you.
And first I just want to start off again by thanking the planning board for all your hours that you've spent doing what you do here, and especially for coming out previous Saturday for a second site walk, and Maureen Amira for coming out on a weekend, and the developers also for showing us around. I think everybody has summed up a lot of what I'm feeling tonight. I would just like to speak to the process, and I'm kind of feeling I have a lot of ideas and a lot of suggestions, but I'm almost feeling like it's too late because this is the second opportunity the public has had to speak directly to you. I know you've received our emails and our letters. Which is great that we can do that, but I think there's a lot more to be said for direct communication and be able to have responses to questions and be able to look people in the face and say what's on our mind. And the first time we had this opportunity was in December. Even at that point in time, I believe it was almost too late because the developer had already spent time and money and resources developing a plan. And, you know, I know that every minute, every day that goes by, it's costing the developer money, so they're less likely to feel inclined to make changes at that time because there's a financial, obviously a financial impact. However, it's equally important that the residents and neighbors who, the ones who are most directly affected and townspeople in general have a right to give input into the design of this plan, which so dramatically affects our lives. And in this case, it's I think you're hearing a lot more voices because there's so many people abutting this area than, and see a direct impact on our lives. And we just want to make sure that it's developed and designed in a way that will have the least impact on our neighborhoods. So I wish we still, I guess for future projects, I would like you to consider how to give residents and the public more of a direct input in the design process. I know nobody can ever reach 100% agreement, but at least there could be a feeling that people are more directly involved and the voices are heard from the very, very beginning stages before the developer has invested so much time and money. And I know at this stage in the process, I'm kind of feeling like it's almost like it's a done deal, frankly. But for whatever it's worth, I'd like to offer some of my suggestions. And as Larry Stern had said earlier, my neighbor, this whole process has been very educational, and the benefits have been I've become, hopefully, a much more cognizant citizen of this town as far as the comprehensive plan, the future development. I'm really looking at this project as far as not just how it directly impacts me, but looking at just the general future development of Cape Elizabeth and the comprehensive plan. One of my concerns is with the density of the development, the impact on services in this town. Right now we're feeling extreme financial pressures on public services. Obviously the schools is a big one, but from everywhere from the roads to transfer station, and public works, et cetera. And I just want to be sure that the numbers of families attracted to this development at this point in time will not be an excessive burden on services to the town. I'm not opposed to development. I think it can be done sensibly. I think it can be done in this case in a way that has less of an impact on neighborhoods, be less obtrusive. Some of the factors I would like you to consider again is the buffering. And again, that does not directly impact me. I'm far away from the development, but I know some of the neighbors who are. If there's a way to create a larger buffer, more screening, and I know on our site walk we viewed those spots, and there's so much natural beauty to the area and the adjacent lots. My question is, can't more of that be preserved as a natural buffer rather than cutting it all down and planting new vegetation when you have, you know, a huge, beautiful forest behind your house? Why not preserve that as the buffer and just extend it out more? So I would ask you to look at that. As far as the open space goes, I know in the ordinance it says that the open space should be dedicated to recreational amenity and environmental enhancement of the development and must protect natural resources, and also is capable of being used and enjoyed for the purpose of informal and unstructured recreation and relaxation. You know, is the open space designated for this development, is that the most usable open space for the public to enjoy? Is there a different way to restructure it so that there is, could the open space be put in a different area and the buildings located in another area so that there would be more, so that the open space would be more usable? Some of the open space that's designated now, I understand, is more marginal land. A lot of it is wetland, and I don't know how much of that could actually be used by the public. And obviously another issue is the increased traffic, which the current neighborhoods, which are quiet, dead-end street neighborhoods, are very concerned about, and I would be very much in support of a gate on Chicory Way to limit the traffic in those neighborhoods. And I guess I would just like to close with saying that I was very struck by the comprehensive plan survey that went out to the town, where it was very clear that the overwhelming number one goal was to preserve the natural beauty and rural character of this town. And I think we need to be very cognizant of that in the developments that we're approving in this town. Again, I am not opposed to development. I'm not opposed to this development. I think it could be redesigned in a way that is less obtrusive to the neighborhoods, that can preserve more of the natural beauty of the area. I just feel, you know, it's late in the process to have a big redesign, but I'm putting it out there that maybe that still could be done. And I think, you know, we need to look at this development, how it impacts the surrounding neighborhoods, and also what kind of trend it sets for the future in this town. Thank you.
Thank you. Does anybody else wish to speak on the application? And I will now close the public hearing, and thank you all for coming out again tonight. We appreciate it. And I appreciate many of the comments complimenting us for our public service. I'll tell you, this has been, in my 6 years on the planning board, the most difficult application that I've ever had to deal with. And I know many of you already. I respect your points of view. I'm sympathetic to your points of view, and this is not a whole lot of fun necessarily for me to sit here and deal with this application. However, that being said, we have a job to do, and we're going to try to do that job tonight. And at this point, we as a board need to begin our discussion of the application. We have a proposed memo that lists scores of findings of fact. However, I would be interested, before we get into that, whether in light of the public comments that we've received tonight, if there are any specific questions that members of the board have for the applicant that they wish to raise now, or any other questions that they feel appropriate to raise now.
We have lots, but I'll let somebody else go first.
I'd like to maybe ask Maureen. The process seems to be a big issue here for sure, and how we would go about proposing. I mean, it's not for this board to decide how the process is handled. I assume is part of the town charter. Is that what describes how often you have a public hearing? Because it sounds like maybe for a major subdivision, it would be better to have a third public, you know, a sooner public hearing in the process. But that requires changes that I wouldn't even know where to start.
Yeah. My understanding is we would have to go back to the ordinance and amend the ordinance, because that does lay out a procedure for how these things work. And I certainly have heard everyone's comments on the process. That does concern me when a lot of people I know and respect are irate over what they view as shortcomings in the process. We're not ignoring that, but for purposes of this application, there's not a great deal to be done, especially at this time. But I do think that that's something that we as a board can submit to the town council for consideration, for amending the procedures for major subdivision review for the next one that comes down the pipeline. And it doesn't do a whole lot for you folks, I understand. I don't know if anybody else wants to speak to that.
No, I would echo that. We could talk about putting that on a workshop to discuss about how we would approach the town council to make the changes. And, you know, that's a whole lot of work, and I'm prepared to do it to make the process such that there is more public input on bigger projects for the reasons that many of the abutters have identified. It impacts a lot of people just in the neighborhood, aside from the town impact, which we're always considering. But that we have a job to do, Dave. And
I echo that concern. But go ahead, Jack.
I'd like to make one quick comment in response to something alluded to by one or two of the last speakers. We never meet in closed session behind closed doors to conjure up what we think is best for any development or any plan. The only time the planning board would meet in closed session would be with an attorney present for some special reason. There is never a case where the planning board meets behind closed doors for any of these purposes that we're talking about tonight. Just to clarify that point.
Okay. Barbara.
And just to further clarify, I've been frustrated by the process, too. I have to tell you, and I've told the planning board members that I am, because I, too, think that there should be more involvement from the community, and they all know I've said that. And unfortunately, we didn't change the process in midstream here, or try to. But I'd also like to let everybody in this room know, we are not allowed to talk to each other either. So while we don't talk to you directly, and I've met some of you in various places, and I've said, I'm sorry, but I can't discuss the project, we can't meet individually and discuss the project either. We can only talk about things in public, either here or at the workshops. So it's not just you we can't talk to. We can't talk to anybody. I talk to my husband, and that's the only person that I've talked to. But just to let you know that we don't sit around, I don't call them, and they don't call me, and we don't sit around and talk about it. So maybe that'll help a little bit. And I was going to make another point, and it escaped me in saying that. So I'll think about it later.
I have another point on the process, but also the direction, and then I want to let it go. But it does address some of the concerns that I've heard. One of the concerns that I've heard is that we would like to see possibly a look at a more traditional arrangement rather than the cluster arrangement, which is totally the opposite of where the town's direction is in terms of the charge they want, they've given to staff and to the board. That is totally a town council function as to which direction people want to see the town development to be. And frankly, I urge you to write to the council, have them look at that, and frankly, let's put it on the table and air it out as a town rather than looking to us as a board to implement something that's just the opposite of what we've been asked to do by the ordinance and by the policy directions that we've been given. I want that out there so people understand that this has moved in a direction because that's the direction that the ordinance pushes development toward and the policy directives that we've been given from the council. So having said that, we have to consider what's in front of us, given the rules that we have in front of us, and that's all I'm going to say.
If I could just suggest that we start to get into the substantive issues. I happen to agree with that policy for purposes of future development in our town, but I don't have the last say on that. For now, I am obligated to try to carry that out. And I have all kinds of speeches rehearsed for tonight, but I think given the hour, we ought to start dealing with some of the issues in fairness to all the people who are here and the applicant.
Can we just allay one fear?
Sure.
There were several emails about the fact that the condominium development was going to double or triple. Everybody remembers reading that. There were some people that were afraid that 23 units were being approved, but really they were then going to come back and ask for another 60. And that's not true. I mean, at least know that if this development is approved the way it is, they can't ask for any more. That's it. The open space is given in perpetuity, and the number of units cannot increase.
I think the confusion was created by the fact that the bylaws for the Condominium Association
declaration,
thank you, made reference to an increased number of units. So maybe we could clear that one up. Is there any reason why the declaration couldn't be changed?
That's perfectly appropriate.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Barbara. All right.
Let's talk about the gate.
Okay. Sean, you brought it up, so you begin.
Okay. I like, there's been quite a few emails and some discussion this evening about this flexible gate idea. And I like that. I think that we should be able to at least put some forethought into what could potentially happen. Of course, we can't predict what can happen, but we could put a little bit of thought into it and try and make things a little flexible so that if and when something might happen, we've got things covered. And I thought that there was some good thought put into that, and I think that we should consider having maybe initially a gate on South Street, but then able to be moved to Chicory Way in some way, some kind of easements that allow that to happen. I thought that was, should some things happen, we can do this. If this happens, we do this.
I'd also, can I ask the Tom question about the, if there were a review, in other words, if we approved a gate that said we're not going to put this in until we have some measurements at some point in the future, what would you, and I'm not saying it's going that way or not, what would you recommend in terms of when we should look at this? Meaning, you know, you don't want to gather the data too early when the thing isn't built out well enough or even sold, frankly, because all we know, it could sit empty for a while.
Well, actually, I think, though, part of the concern is cut-through traffic.
Right.
As opposed to the traffic necessarily being generated by the development. So it would seem to me the cut-through traffic would occur fairly early in the project.
Okay, and that's a good answer because that makes sense to me.
Yeah, so...
How early in would you... I mean, when the road's done, when the first house is sold, half the units are sold? I mean, obviously we want to... Go ahead.
Well, our initial proposal, you know, was, I think, something like when 70 or 75% were constructed. But again, if the concern is cut through traffic, then you could do it within probably 6 months or so of once that roadway was put in. I know there was concern about when you would do it, and I think we'd want to listen a lot to when people thought was most appropriate to do it, whether it be checking it on the weekend a little bit and during the weekday, during the summer months, that sort of thing. But it's, I think, again, with the issue being cut-through traffic, we could do it fairly early on. We wouldn't have to necessarily wait until 75% of it was constructed. And, you know, I think we would do it by, there's a variety of ways you can actually do it. But what we're interested in is the people that enter at one end and depart on the other. It's through traffic. And there are ways that we can technically track that traffic, so and match it up and see if, in fact, they were through trips.
Thank you. That's interesting.
Paul? Thank you, Peter, for bringing that up. Again, I'm going to restate my position that I do not believe a gate initially is where I think we should be headed. I think we are putting the cart before a horse a little bit. I do believe, ultimately, that if built and if monitored, we could all be assured that the amount of traffic going through there is at a reasonable level, and we could determine a reasonable level of traffic. And yes, if it exceeded it, then a gate would probably be a measure that could be implemented to eliminate the amount of cut-through traffic. I had actually written a monitoring condition that that's a point we get to, we can talk about and discuss, but it's somewhat similar to what Tom just outlined. I mean, you know, approximately 6 months after the road was built, it would be possible to track and trace the traffic that would go through and determine the amount of cut-through traffic that was driving through the neighborhood. And yes, if it exceeded a reasonable level, then yes, by all means, I think we have an opportunity to do something about it. But if it doesn't, and the volume is small or negligible, then I think we have the opportunity to, again, have a win-win where we have connectivity. Don't have to worry about unlocking a padlock in the middle of a freezing snowstorm to gain emergency access. Worry whether or not vandalism is going to break a mechanical gate, which I'm not in favor of. I deal with mechanical gates. They're not a good idea, especially in this climate that we deal with. But again, I think it ultimately goes to, one, the fears that folks have. I don't blame you. I, if I, you know, living in that neighborhood, you do have concerns about additional traffic. And if they reach certain thresholds, yes, there should be something done by this board and by the town about it. But if there isn't, and if there is an opportunity to have connectivity and having the ability to make sure that that traffic does not exceed reasonable levels, that is something I would encourage my fellow planning board members to consider.
Jeff?
Relative to the gate, I think if there is going to be a gate, and I have some mixed feelings about it myself, but if there is going to be a gate, the only time it's going to happen is now, through a mandate by the planning board. There's simply too much sentiment against the gate on the part of various town staff for it to happen otherwise. So if we are going to have it at all, I think we have to do it now.
Barbara?
As a planning tool, and I know I said that I'd be in favor of the gate because of the abutters, and I still am, but as a planning tool, I don't think it's the best planning tool. I think that, you know, I think we'd have to go back to the beginning and start all over again with this in terms of a planning tool. But in terms of the gate, we don't have control after this project is finished. Then it becomes the town, the people who work for the town that will make those decisions. It's out of our hands. So I think whatever we insist has to be done, we need to build it in very carefully. And I'm concerned if there is a gate, I want to know what kind of a design it has. What is it, two poles with a chain, or is it something really sturdy so that some kids aren't going to go through it? I think the only fair place, if we have one, for it to be is where it's shown on the plan now. I have always been worried about the South Street, about the other side. And that is a much less vocal side. There are fewer people there, and there are fewer people who appear to be interested. But that traffic's going to be bad on that side. I'm convinced of it. And if we have a gate, it needs to divide the traffic in half to me. I don't know how much cut-through traffic is going to be. I don't know if anybody knows until it happens. But I do know that most of the traffic is going to go out through Spurwink and Stevenson. I don't think there's a question about it. It's much quicker and closer to get to Portland. And that's the only right place to me. We could build in something that and that could be 10 years from now, that the farm, Maxwell's farm, will be sold, that the gate could be moved. But as a pure planning tool, it's not the best tool in the whole world. However, in terms of the abutters, maybe it is a decent solution.
David?
My feeling on the gate is that I guess I have two comments. One is that I concur with Jack Keneally's point is that that if it goes in, that it has to be done properly now, not later. I have a question relative to Paul's comment. If the gate is not put in, Paul, are you considering other calming methods for the neighborhood, or would you wait until it was determined the gate was needed or wasn't needed?
If the gate is put in place now, I do not believe other traffic calming measures in the neighborhoods would be required. If the gate does not go in, again, I would like to see as many traffic calming measures as is reasonable and practical to continue to deter potential cut-through traffic.
I view traffic calming measures necessary regardless of whether there's a gate. I mean, if we're saying there is not, if all the experts are saying there's not much of a potential for cut-through traffic, and then the gate really doesn't change that. So I'm not quite seeing the connection there between the gate and traffic calming measures. I think we need traffic calming measures because they're going to be 40 plus units in the middle of these two neighborhoods, and if there's a gate in the middle, then 20 on either side are still going through the existing neighborhoods, ergo you need traffic calming measures. So I still am going to be advocating for that regardless. I am relying, however, on all of the experts, Gorel Palmer, Mr. Errico, who have said they do not foresee a significant amount of cut-through traffic. And And I tend to agree with those conclusions. I cannot imagine if I am living on Mitchell Road or the Oakhurst area that to get to 77, I'm going to decide to cut through three neighborhoods to get from point A to point B. It just doesn't make any sense to me. However, I'm willing to acknowledge I may be wrong and that all these studies may be wrong, and I think we can build into a condition of approval the notion of a study to be conducted that gives us specific criteria for when a gate would be required or not be required. And I'd like to say that I have faith in our town staff that they would agree to abide by that condition of approval. And this project, if we talk about a study that's being done 7 months out, they're still in the midst of building it out. They still need to get things like building permits, I assume. We can include a provision in the approval that says no more building permits shall be issued unless this particular condition that we put in place now is satisfied. So I would really I'm really hoping that I can convince my fellow members of the planning board to not give up on the idea of having a gate come in after the fact if with that sort of condition. There's just a whole host of reasons why I think it makes sense not to have a gate. Again, all the traffic that's on either side, they want to, as a crow flies, travel 100 yards. They've got to take an incredibly circuitous route by car to get there. Hopefully people will ride bikes and walk. But you know, I see it again and again in our town that neighborhoods are not connected, and that means everybody goes out onto the main arteries. It's more gas, more wear and tear on the roads. It seems to me to make better sense from a planning standpoint to not require a gate at the outset. That being said, I find this difficult because here I am saying, well, I know better than you guys. I'm just relying on what the experts are telling us, what the traffic studies have told us, and I think it makes sense from a planning standpoint. I think 5 or 10 years down the road, we're going to be happy we went this way. I know it's easy for me to say, but that's how I come out on it.
And I would view your proposal, Dave, as addressing it now, Jack, that we're going to handle the issue now. We may not ask the gate be installed now, but we're going to set out the criteria that if the cut-through traffic is more than all the studies have shown, the gate goes in, or, you know, to the extent we can require it. I mean, the town council is another story.
But I also don't think we should give up on other traffic calming measures, even if 4 out of the 7 of us go for the gate. I still think we should consider those. But we'll reach those later. Go ahead, Barbara.
If a decision is made, whether it's to be put in a gate now or put in a gate, I have some real apprehension about doing things later. But if it's later, I think there ought to be an escrow fund set up for it with money put into it. I think we ought to dictate what kind of a gate it has to be, where it has to go, and whether or not it should be removed and moved over to Chicory once Maxwell Farm is developed. I think all those things need to be very clearly and carefully spelled out because, frankly, people try to wheedle out of things.
I no question.
And this and the town staff is vehemently opposed to a gate. And I want to know that they can't have the gate removed when the road, if we put one, require one to go in, that when the road converts to the town, that the town can't decide to take it away.
See, I believe
they don't like it.
I believe ultimately they could. My strong suspicion, Barbara, I mean, even if we required the gate today, I believe that the town would have the authority, correct me if I'm wrong, to remove it. I am guessing that members of our town council would not undertake that step, but I can't predict what they do this time around or 5 years from now.
And Barbara, I agree with you. Again, I like very clear, very specific language that deals with this because, again, if it needs to happen, we want to make sure that it's carried out based on the, you know, what this planning board, you know, collectively decides is the appropriate way to do it.
Having spent all this time reviewing this, I don't see our efforts go to waste.
No.
Any more discussion or questions on the issue of the gate? or connectivity or cut-through traffic. Jack? Oh.
I'd like to make a couple more comments about the gate. The gate's a very unusual solution to a set of problems. But I think the reason that we are considering such an unusual solution is because we have a very unusual situation here. I don't know that we've ever had a situation in this town where we're putting in a significant new neighborhood behind an existing neighborhood.
Between
two existing neighborhoods, so behind two existing neighborhoods. I really don't believe that the neighborhood that we're talking about, the existing neighborhood, is concerned only about cut-through traffic. They're concerned about the fact that they have an existing neighborhood, has a certain kind of integrity to it, a self-contained neighborhood, and they're going to lose that in addition to the through traffic. And so that was an additional reason for the gate. And the gate's a very unusual step to take, but I believe in this case it deserves some consideration. I also believe that 10 years downstream is possible. This neighborhood may say, we don't want the gate anymore. I'd rather see it go that way. Give them the gate now, let them decide. 5 years from now, 7 years from now, the gate's a nuisance, we don't want it, take it out. I think that is a better solution to the problem we have in front of us.
All right. While we're on the issue of traffic, perhaps we ought to discuss the other traffic calming measures. And I would like to focus on the issue of the sidewalk, since there was quite a bit of discussion about that during the site walk. Anyone care to comment on that?
Sure.
Barbara?
Well, my sense from the neighbors were that most people like the idea of a sidewalk. But I think we need to be exceedingly flexible and not say we have to have a 5-foot sidewalk and a 5-foot esplanade, but rather we're going to go with the contours of the land, and it's actually going to be planned so that it's attractive. And I agree that, now Dermot's an easy street, it's just a little straight street, but the sidewalk there is not displeasing. It's asphalt, it kind of goes with the road, but I know what the code requires, 5 and 5, but I'm not sure that in this case that we have to be quite that rigid. And I'd also think that my sense of the neighborhood was that if we could cut out some of the road where it's 24 or 26 feet and not go into the, unfortunately the lawns are very small in some places, and many people now have their lawn in the right of way, that we should try to avoid that as much as possible and try to make this sidewalk fit nicely within the neighborhood so it looks kind of meandering but gives the children a safe place to walk and to play and to have places to cross the street. I think the other thing, if we do put in a sidewalk, we do need to talk about Thrasher and how to put stop signs there too, because that isn't clear to me that those weren't on any plans either.
I agree with your comments, Barbara. One of the proposed conditions, if we were to approve this subdivision tonight, is that the sidewalk and esplanade on Columbus Road would take into consideration existing conditions and vary the design and placement of the sidewalk and esplanade to preserve mature trees and minimize dramatic grades. I'm thinking specifically about Ms. Layton's home, where going to the sidewalk was very helpful because that might be an area where it just doesn't make sense to have a 5-foot esplanade. The sidewalk would be a third or halfway into her front yard. And also, there's a mature tree there that would have to be taken out. So I think what I heard from the town planner during the site walk was that in past projects we have allowed to take into consideration existing physical constraints when placing a sidewalk, so that in many areas you would have a 5-foot esplanade with the street trees, but in some areas it would shift over and run alongside the roadway. So that's what I would be in favor of, assuming the board were to require a sidewalk. I'm not sure necessarily whether we want to require the sidewalk to continue around the corner of Ms. LaBrie's, I'm sorry, I'm just speaking by name because I don't know the house numbers, the LaBrie property and then the Moran property. If you have a sidewalk the entire length of Columbus Road, do you want to require it to continue on around those two properties or not? I don't know if anybody's given that any thought. Right. I mean, again, if we have that condition built in, we ought to perhaps you shift the sidewalk out so it runs along the roadway there. Chances are cars aren't going to be able to go too fast in that little stretch because it's so short, and that you wouldn't be as concerned about losing an esplanade. That was just my thought, Paul.
David, if I can, I'll echo both yours and Barbara's comments relative to the sidewalk. I guess where I want to understand where we're heading with this is, are we talking about giving the individual property owners the choice of whether or not there's a sidewalk with or without an esplanade in terms of how much of their front lawn it takes? I think if sidewalks are put in, I would like to see them put in conjunction with roadway narrowing, again, as an additional traffic calming measure, and again, as a way of also minimizing, you know, impact to front yards. But I guess I'm just trying to get to the root of how do we determine esplanade, no esplanade, and, you know, is it, you know, if somebody told me I had to have a sidewalk in front of the yard, yeah, I'd like to have some say in terms of what it might look like. So, you know, where are we headed with this?
That's a good question, and my concern is the default or the rule ought to be an esplanade, unless there is a mature tree or a grading issue, which I think was both of those were present at the Layton property. If we leave it up to everyone's choice, we may not have any esplanade, and then it's not a very good traffic calming measure. So I don't know. I'm looking for any ideas on how we could deal with that?
Well, how about a plan?
A specific plan.
I mean, and we don't have that in front of us.
No, we don't.
No.
It seems to me we need one.
Yeah. Go ahead. I wasn't suggesting no esplanade. I was simply suggesting that maybe in some places where the road is narrower, that we don't have a 5-foot esplanade and right. A 5-foot, you know, that we agree to alter so that it may go to a 4 and a 4 or something that works a little bit better. But I wasn't, because I think the esplanade will work as a traffic calming measure.
I think what we discussed at the sidewalk was that sort of concept. We try to maintain the 5-foot esplanade, but where it didn't make sense because of existing constraints, you narrow the esplanade or you eliminate the esplanade. So it's sort of a weaving effect. I still like the chicane idea, but I know that wasn't overly popular. Okay. Did you have anything else?
No, it would be good for both us and folks to be able to react to some type of a plan that has taken into account existing topography, existing conditions. You know, we could all speculate on what it might look like, but something to react to might be more appropriate than us just trying to wing it.
I think the more basic question, though, is if 4 out of the 7 of us agree that a gate is required and then 4 out of 7 of us don't think any other traffic calming measures are necessary, then it's all academic. So I guess we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. Any other questions or issues the board wants to raise? Paul?
We still have some outstanding issues relative to mitigation at the intersections of Columbus and Mitchell and also at Stevenson and Spurwink. I'd like to go on record as saying at the intersection of Columbus and Mitchell, I do believe it would be appropriate to remove some of the trees between the existing rock wall and the roadway as an opportunity to increase sight distance. I'm not in favor of relocating the rock wall. I think that's too obtrusive, but I do believe, based on being out in the field, that you can improve sight distance at that location by removing trees. Over at Stevenson and Spurwink, I do believe there is a need for addition of stop signs, especially given the very limited and lack of sight distance at that intersection. Currently proposed, I believe, is a 3-way stop that might be able to be cut down to a 2-way stop, one northbound on Spurwink and one coming out of Stevenson, with the also the opportunity to cut back some brush and limbs coming out of Stevenson, relocating some of the mailboxes, but I do believe there needs to be an opportunity, one, to install stop signs for safety, and two, to improve sight distance. So that's something I would like to suggest to board members be considered.
Well, what do you make of the comments of the neighbors that the issue with the sight distance is not the trees, but it's the I'm talking about Mitchell Road and Columbus Road.
Go on to something else then?
Certainly.
All right, I'm concerned about the buffering. We spent 3 hours that Saturday morning, and you added one tree. And that really bothered me. I didn't count them. I think there are six people that are fairly close there. Part of the McGrath's lot, Foley, I think that belongs to somebody else now. Loring, Valley, Darling, and Barker, that are very close to the lot lines. Their properties are only 15 feet or so from where the buildings are going to go. And two people have been quite vocal about what they wanted, and that was Darling and Valley, and you added one tree in that area. And I thought I was going to come in and see a whole string of trees and some things. I know they asked for a 1,000-foot stockade fence. I know that's really expensive, but surely some more trees could have been added in that area. And also, what size are they going to be? Are they going to be 1-inch trees? Are they going to be 6-inch trees and 15 feet high? Or what are they going to be? So if somebody, perhaps, John, you could speak to that.
One of our planning board members needs to make a quick call. We've been at this for 3 hours. I would just suggest we take a 5-minute break. Second. Okay, we will resume in 5 minutes, folks. Just need to deal with a few things. Thanks. Yeah. everyone's indulgence. Just need to check in with sitters and the like. I believe we'll let John Mitchell address the question that was posed before we took the break, and then I want to just discuss a few procedural issues with the board. So, I'm sorry, I forgot what the question was.
Buffering.
About buffering, and also talk
about the
Moran property too.
Yes.
Sorry.
Right.
And that there's not agreement about that. I mean, you came up with one idea. His was probably too elaborate. Maybe yours was a little too simple. There's a middle ground.
Well, as I mentioned in my presentation, I asked the board to remember when we were out there standing in this location here, and we talked about the significant extent of the existing evergreen vegetation, mature evergreen vegetation. In fact, behind the Dowling property, it was very, I mean, you could see her house, but it was quite a ways in the distance. And between where we were standing and her back lawn, there was approximately 80 to 100 feet of existing vegetation. However, we have continued to show an evergreen buffer along her property and the valley property. It's at the location where the road is closest to the property line. But please remember that there is a significant amount of existing vegetation in that area already. It would be pointless to add more vegetation.
I wasn't asking about their property. I was asking about the other abutters.
Same thing. We went out there, and we stood behind Mr. Foley's house, and there's a significant amount of existing vegetation in along that property line between our property line and their backyards.
Barbara, was there a specific property owner that you were most concerned about?
Well, they wrote a letter. All of them wrote a letter that we have. We all got it.
Remember the McGrath property?
And they all signed it and asked for, I mean, they did ask for stockade fence and maybe, you know, what the abutters want and what the developers want are very far apart. And what we need to try to do is come with some kind of a medium solution, because nobody should have to do everything, and a 1,000-foot stockade fence may be, you know, way over the top, but perhaps it's, you know, some more trees along there could be added. I mean, John's saying no, that it's not necessary.
I don't see him saying no. What I hear the developer saying is we're willing to put them all in there on our property up as best we can on that corner.
But they're not showing on the property. They're just showing behind the two most vocal people, who are Darling and Valley.
No, they're showing where the road is.
That's where the
closest,
road is closest
to their property line. That's
the road is the closest, but the other abutters are almost as close to the house lots and the house lines.
Well, I mean, we've got a 15-foot buffer between the backs of the proposed lots and our property line. But in addition to that, there is substantial existing vegetation, and also remember from the site visit that much of this area is existing wetlands.
Yeah, this is over here.
And we can't plant in the wetlands. And for those reasons, I mean, it was just, I appreciate their concerns, but it was, in my opinion, unreasonable to request more plantings than what we have proposed. We have added two red pines to the Moran property. The quote that I received this evening showed 12 trees.
I understand that.
I was corrected. In Mr. Moran's presentation, he said all he wanted was two trees, so we've met his requirement on that.
And before we leave Mr. Moran, there was also the notion of shrubs versus trees to deal with the headlight issue coming into his front yard. It sounded like maybe he'd prefer shrubs, assuming the same. I mean, I'm assuming the cost would be around the same.
Yeah, so I don't have, apparently I don't have the most up-to-date
information from Mr. Moran.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Moran, would you mind just coming back up and telling us what your preference was? Come back to the podium, just so we... This issue seems fairly discreet.
Mr. Moran's property is a different location, right?
Right. This is... yeah, he's on the other side.
He's over by Kildare. He's over by Chicory, where Chicory's going to come.
Right, but I thought John Mitchell just... You were just talking about that, weren't you?
Yes, that's correct. Yeah. He's right here.
Okay.
Would you mind, sir?
They proposed two red pines. My landscaper proposed two Austrian pines or five smaller shrubs-type plantings. I'd rather go with the shrubs. That way I can shape them and...
Okay, I'm seeing nodding of heads from the applicant that they would be willing to do that.
Okay. That's fine.
I figured that was a fairly non-controversial issue, so
yep.
I thought I'd try to get rid of one. Hey, I did something tonight. All right. But getting back to the Macaulay Road people, I'm willing to impose a requirement for buffering when I think it makes sense and when it's mandated by what's out there. And I got to tell you, Barbara, I didn't see it. And to the credit of the Darlings, I don't think they're here tonight, they didn't clear cut their lot to the very back of their property line, or oftentimes happens, people go into the applicant's property and then they say, oh, build me a buffer. I mean, they've responsibly, it seems to me, maintained a buffer between themselves and all of Spurwink Woods. And even the other property owners, I just didn't see the need to impose additional requirements where I'm inclined to require a sidewalk and other fairly expensive items. I just didn't see it here.
I think also Maureen, I think isn't in the subdivision ordinance, there is some 16th, I think I quoted it once at a meeting, four meetings ago, that there is a requirement that says that the subdivision, the entire property, could be ringed with bushes if we require that.
It's one of the standards in 16.3.1. It says plants, existing vegetation or plants, need to be planted around the perimeter of the project.
Right. If vegetation is cut up to
right.
the property
exactly.
line, which could be the case there where those lots are.
Yes, that's true. And it is also the case right here behind units 11 and 12, where we're clearing right up to the property line, and we're proposing to revegetate that.
Before, go ahead. Are you
John,
leaving the Darling? Are you leaving the
no,
Macaulay Road?
No, John. About the sidewalk. Again, tell the rationale for having it on the side that it's on, as opposed to moving it to the
yes.
other side.
Yes. The rationale is. There isn't much room at all between our right-of-way line and the edge of pavement and the property line in this area here. In fact, we're proposing a retaining wall, a guardrail, to accommodate this alignment. There is no room for in addition to the retaining wall and guardrail, there's no room to put a sidewalk. That's the reason for placing the sidewalk on the easterly side of the road until we get to Franklin Circle. And it is a logical place at this point to cross here. And then from this point on, it's all on the northerly side.
On the comments we received from the Darlings as well as their neighbors, they also raised the issue of blasting and foundations, and I know that the town ordinance or code speaks to that, but would you be willing just to explain how that works to protect existing homes against possible damage to their foundations
yep.
in the event of blasting?
I'll try, and I'll ask Skip. If I miss something, I'll ask Skip to supplement. We have addressed this on several occasions in our documentation throughout the process, but under, I believe, both town and state regulations require a pre-blast survey. and I believe it's a 500-foot radius of the point of blast, where Skip has got to hire a professional to go out and to survey all existing homes, foundations, and to document that, to file it with Bruce Smith here in the town. There are several other mandatory requirements for safety. Skip, if you want to add anything to that.
No, that's basically it in a nutshell, and one of the abutters approached me on the sidewalk, and he lives over on Columbus, and he has a well, and we will test his well for, you know, quality, quantity. But anybody, I'm not going to limit it to the 500-foot. I'll send a letter to the entire neighborhood. Anybody that has concerns, we will address, but it's very well mandated, and we will abide by the Town of Cape Elizabeth's rules and then the Bureau of Mine standards. We monitor all the blasts, and it's all independently done by, I use SW Coal Engineering to do all the pre-blast survey. It has nothing to do with me. They meet with the homeowners, do it. It's filed away with no access from me. It protects me as well as the homeowner.
In addition to that, Skip works closely with the fire chief.
Right, I was about to ask the town planner, and she anticipated my question. To the extent there is damage, there is either insurance coverage for that. The applicant has a certificate of insurance on file with the application.
Yes.
To handle those types of
yes.
scenarios. Okay. Did anybody else have any questions or comments on the Macaulay Road requests or concerns? Okay. It is, I'd like to continue to have us ask questions and try to delve into as many issues as possible within reason. I'm not sure I'm hearing from the board, but you speak up if you disagree with me, that we're going to be in a position to approve this application tonight with conditions given the sidewalk issue. But what? Peter, go ahead.
I would like to see a plan for the sidewalks. I don't see a way to structure an approval that we can defer that issue. It's too many loose ends, I guess, to structure an approval. Okay. Or meaning to even put a motion together for consideration. I do think we have some other issues to hash out. I hear the applicant's about to address that. Go ahead, Barbara.
No, well maybe what we need to do is decide about the gate and the sidewalks first. Before we ask the applicant to develop a sidewalk plan, let's make sure that's what all of us think that should happen. I mean, I don't want to make them to go to a lot of nuisance without an expense, without us, unless we all concur that that's what should happen.
Sidewalks down Columbus.
Yes. I mean, I think we need to decide whether all of us feel, you know, or the majority of us feel that sidewalks are a good solution, and also about the gate, because some people may feel if a gate is required, then sidewalks shouldn't be required. So before we ask the applicant to submit a plan, we should decide whether that plan makes sense in terms of everything else. I don't mean all the other points. I agree that we're ready, but I think we need to make those two decisions so we can give the applicant directions.
All right, well, why don't we, before we leave this particular issue, that's an important one, I think I've said this before, my feeling is, gate or no gate, my opinion is we should still require sidewalks, and we will need a plan for those.
I see them as totally different, and I see them,
that's fine.
Any way you structure the gate, whether it's now, maybe take it out, or no, maybe put it in, sidewalks ought to go in, because how it seems to me you're not going to get a fair read on, among other things, traffic. So I guess I want to see sidewalks.
Paul, you're looking, it's getting later, so now I'm more willing to put people on the spot, I suppose. You're looking a little pensive, and what are your thoughts, since you have the most expertise in this area?
obviously, the goal in my mind is still making sure that this, when, if this project is approved, that, you know, we make sure it is as safe and as community-friendly as possible. I think sidewalks achieve that. I'm still struggling with, you know, what is fair and reasonable to the applicant, but I think I'm on the side of the fence, and I think it's fair and reasonable to ask that be done.
Any other comments? It sounds like there's a consensus on that front. It may not be unanimous, but I've heard 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
I'm in favor of 2.
Oh, you are. And David hasn't spoken up yet. It's a whole new regime here after 10 o'clock, but it's at least 6, so that's more than the majority.
I guess what I'll say is that I'm not sure I got a consensus of neighbors on Columbus that they wanted sidewalks, but I think that it appears that we're leaning towards a gate regardless. And I would rather see the gate go in than put a sidewalk in, but it looks to me like I'm outnumbered. But that's my position.
I'm going to speak briefly to that one issue. I see the sidewalks clearly larger than the neighborhood. It's a community issue, too. And also, I don't see that as much with the gate. Clearly, the gate is a community issue, but I see that more of a neighbor's issue. So I guess that's why I'm more inclined to look at sidewalks, because I see us protecting the whole town more so than the neighbors, even though certainly they're going to benefit from it.
My only point is that I have always been in favor of sidewalks and new developments, but they become a serious burden on an existing development. And I'm not sure I'm in favor of the contractor taking the full burden for this, and that's my position.
Okay. Given that, it would appear to me that ultimately tonight we're going to end up with a motion to table. Question for the board is, to what extent we get into other issues. A lot have been raised by all of the neighbors tonight. We can continue to go forward and try to get through as many as possible. We can set a time limit. What are people's pleasure?
I think after a while everybody gets fuzzy. Okay. And we're not thinking very clearly after 3 hours and 15 minutes.
David?
Chairman, I think you've got a couple issues that you could take care of now. Okay. You've just talked about them. Might as well get them off the table.
Well, I'm inclined to try to get some off the table if we can, to make the next time we come back a bit more streamlined. Could we go on for another 15 to 30 minutes?
30 minutes for me.
30 minutes, okay. Yeah. Mr.
Yeah, just a quick question, Tom Borler. We would like to have the question of the gate resolved as one issue, if that's possible, so we understand where that's going to go, because we have been talking about that for a while, and I know you did some discussion, but I wasn't sensing that you had a consensus.
I think you're absolutely right, and we'll find out in a minute, but if there is going to be a gate in this plan, you need to know that so we can get a design of the gate when we come back next month as well. So there are a couple of proposals. One is to not require a gate at the outset and revisit it with a study, a traffic study, to determine if we're all wrong on the issue of cut-through traffic and that a gate is necessary to prevent that. That's one approach. I've heard from a couple of board members that don't like that we really ought to just get the gate in now or else it'll never happen. And then there's some board members. Maybe that's it. Are those the two approaches?
Those are the two approaches, and I would put on the table language and emotion that I would consider and put it open for debate. Is one way to try to address it, and I would, if with the chairs,
that would be fine.
That is part of any approval. I would require as a condition that the applicant it's late, submit design details for the emergency access gate, so we have that submitted in. And then approximately 6 months, 12 months, and 18 months after the completion of South Street and Chicory Way, a traffic study will be conducted at the applicant's expense by the town of Cape Elizabeth's designated traffic engineer. The purpose of the traffic studies will be to determine the level of cut-through traffic generated by the connection of Dermot Drive and Kildare Road. If the traffic study determines that the volume of cut-through traffic trips exceeds 25 trips during the peak hour, then the emergency gate would be installed as shown on the plans. A cut-through trip will be defined as a trip beginning and ending outside of the existing neighborhoods adjacent to Sperling Courts. And the reason, Paul and I had some minor discussion on it during the meeting here, and the reason I added extra tests was my concern was during the construction, I don't see the cut-through use being dramatic, because who's going to cut through during the construction? This doesn't, until it's more built out, I guess I want to see it over a period of time to see whether this is an increasing problem, a stable problem, as we're hoping, at the volumes that we're talking about. That would be my proposed language.
Just one comment. I may be wrong in this, but I think that before the development can be developed, the road structure has to be completed, sidewalks and...
Wait, but I'm talking about once... I'm not sure I understand.
Well, I mean, what I mean is that people are going to tend to use that knowing that the road is finished. They are ever going to use it, but the roadway will be finished before anything else is done, if I'm not mistaken.
And I believe that's what Peter's saying, David, is that once the road is completed, so yes, 6 months after the road is completed, there may or may not be any houses constructed, but my opinion is that cut-through traffic would be likely to occur immediately after the roadway is completed.
I'm not opposed to it. I just wanted a multiple for the reason I stated. Maybe that's not valid.
Well, we talked about building permits earlier, and the town planner mentioned to me that we tie this into number of building permits. I think at this late hour, I might rather have you explain this, but we could be that the studies occur after a certain number of building permits have been issued or a certain number of homes have been completed.
Yeah, well, occupancy permits?
But Paul's shaking his head.
My only concern is that obviously I know this development is approved, that the applicant would like to build as many homes, you know, as soon as, you know, people say we want to have them. But what if they didn't? What if the infrastructure was built and then only one home was built? You know, cut-through traffic is going to occur as soon as that roadway connection is made. I think our charge is to make sure that that level of it is not exceeding a reasonable threshold. So I'm more likely not to tie it to a number of housing units built, but more of a time after the connection is made.
What's your concern, Maureen?
I'm not suggesting that your time be deleted. I'm just suggesting that there's been a deep amount of concern expressed on the nefariousness of town staff. And in the past, when conditions have been placed that put a cap on the number of building permits issued before performance has to be performed, nobody else can lift that condition but the planning board.
Okay.
So there would be a guarantee that it would have to come back here. If you did a study and it showed that the peak hour trips exceeded 25, the gate would have to be installed.
Or no more
building permits would be issued.
Oh, I see.
Or it has to come back to the planning board for you to lift the condition that caps the building permits.
So where would that go? That if it exceeds...
Someplace very careful.
So then an emergency gate would be installed as shown on the plans prior to the issuance of any building permits?
No additional building permits would be...
Let me ask the question. You stated that you wanted the study to be done at 6, 12, and 18 months?
That was my proposal, yes.
Okay. If at any one of those points the peak hour trips exceed 25, that would be when you would want the gate installed.
That's correct.
Right?
That's the proposal.
So you could say as soon as the study is done, the first time you hit the peak hour at 25, no more building permits can be issued until, and you want to cap the number. I would say no more than 5 additional building permits can be issued. You don't want the applicant in the situation where they find out that tomorrow they can't get any more building permits.
Right.
But
without a fair chance to come back.
What you're doing is you're establishing a cap, and the ordinance did establish a cap for the provision of affordable housing in Cross Hill. And I don't know if the planning board remember, but there was definitely some controversy regarding the willingness to actually construct the affordable housing. And the cap was imposed, and a stop work order was issued for that project because they weren't in compliance. So there is some history of a building permit cap being tied to a condition that has been upheld in one other instance.
I think that giving that condition some teeth by tying it to the issuance of future building permits makes sense. I think it's a fair approach to allow an additional number of permits to be issued, whether it's three, whether it's five. I think we can deal with later, but I think that would be a fair approach, assuming we go this route, which I still don't know if we have consensus for this.
As we say, that's probably next step, to see whether the board is amenable to this route.
I have one question. Do we need to build anything about escrow in, or is that having it tied to building permits?
I would think if you had a condition like that, you would definitely want an escrow established, and you would want an estimate prepared by the town's traffic engineer of what that escrow amount should be, and then the applicant will be required to put that in the town's name. And, you know, we hold escrows all the time. It's that part is pretty standardized.
I would imagine that the restraint on building permits would be incentive enough, but I don't have an issue with requiring some sort of escrow.
Well, that's why I asked.
Three.
Enough of a constraint.
Peter?
I revamped that paragraph of the motion to say that if the traffic study determines that the volume of cut-through traffic exceeds 25 trips during the peak hour, then no more than three building permits shall be issued until an emergency gate is installed, as shown on the plans. Three permits should give them plenty of time.
And the 25 comes from, that's the amount of cut-through traffic that's...
They're estimating.
Estimating.
Okay.
Yep.
That doesn't come from Mitchell.
Yeah, just everybody keep in mind what a cut-through trip is. It's not somebody from Columbus now going through Chicory and South Street to get out to Spurwink. A cut-through traffic is somebody coming from Mitchell,
right,
coming through, you know, Columbus to Killdeer, through this neighborhood, and then out into Spurwink. It's truly a trip that begins and ends outside of the existing neighborhoods on either side of Spurwink.
And that's similar to the way the proposed ordinance is drafted.
Yeah.
What are members' thoughts on this type of condition relating to the gate? I know Jack and a few others were just concerned that, and I'm not trying to put you on the spot here, but is this amenable? Do we have four out of the seven of us in favor of this type of condition for the gate?
Well, let me make one comment.
Sure.
I hope that Maureen was not alluding to me when she talked about allusions to the nefariousness of town staff.
No.
I recognize that town staff feels differently than I do, but I don't necessarily feel it's nefarious. You have good reasons. Fire chief has good reasons. The public work director has good reasons to believe the way they do, and they feel strongly against the gate. I don't degrade their opinion for any reason. No, nothing wrong with that. Their job requires them to have a good reason for that. I tend to take the other point of view, and my concern here with the proposal that Peter raises is that my concern about the positive aspects of the gate goes beyond the cut-through traffic. We have a special situation here, a new neighborhood being put in behind two existing neighborhoods. And my concern was to try to take a special step in a special case like this to try to preserve as much character as we can of the existing neighborhood without impeding the new development. I'm not anti-development. I think the development's going to be a good one. We have good developers doing this. But I'd like to do what we can to preserve the character of the existing neighborhood, too. So it's not just a cut-through traffic issue for me.
Okay, that's a good point. What is your thought then? Is your inclination then just to require a gate, period?
That would be my inclination, yeah.
Okay. John?
I feel the same about the gate. I think it's more of listening to what we've heard over and over again, and taking that into consideration, as well, I suppose.
Okay. Barbara?
I agree.
David?
I agree strongly with Jack.
Okay, so it sounds to me like we have four in favor of gates, of a safety gate, and three in the minority. So that gives you I don't want people to, this is not set in stone, but I think we've given you all a pretty firm indication of where we come out on this. I can't imagine we'll hear more on this issue, though you all are welcome to send us emails. But I think we've heard that all there is to hear, and the neighborhood desire has prevailed at this point. So I suppose it's possible that could change, but I think we've come out pretty firmly as to where we're going to go on the gate. All right. Peter.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
If I could request, we have two experts on stormwater management sitting here. And I'd appreciate it if the board has any questions or concerns regarding stormwater management that we take advantage of their presence.
By poll, I have none. I mean, those all have been addressed by me. Maybe we can just go down the line with Dave and see if anybody has any questions. I mean, I do compliment the applicant for revamping it the way it's come out. I think it's a good plan. And I have no questions. Certainly have no questions at this point.
Mr. Chairman.
David.
Just one comment, if you're willing to talk about this, John, is that there was one person that spoke tonight who was concerned about the walkway and the public access relative to the position of the level lip spreader. Do you have any reason, do you have anything that you could add to that request? Maybe to put their mind at ease.
What sheet are you?
They were talking about the water flowing off the level slip spreader and going down and the sheet number two, running down on a proposed trail that comes in. My understanding is that the water would be running east rather than that walkway comes off of Spurling, crosses up into wetland,
right,
swings out. The way I saw those level of spread is that the water isn't going to go towards the trail, it's going to go more towards the brook that runs down and through Hamlin Street. Is that the way you see it?
Okay, let me turn to the existing contours.
There was also a question about freezing, about how right, robust yeah. these, how level they're going to remain over a period of time.
And we've gone ahead and put underdrains in as well as drainage stone.
I can't hear the comments.
Oh, sorry. We've gone ahead and put underdrains in as well as drainage stone, same as you would for any foundation, that sort of thing, to alleviate that. So we've taken care of that.
And if there is any channelization after the point of discharge from these level lip spreaders, there will be, you know, culverts to accommodate that under the pathways.
Yep. Primarily, the level lip spreaders are going to come out with sheet flow versus any concentrated flow. So you shouldn't be inundated.
Thank you.
Jack, did you have a question?
I did have a question relating to a question brought up by at least one of the people who spoke. Is there a well-established history of these level lip spreaders of operating in this kind of climate and not being affected by frost heaves, things like that?
Yes, there is a well. They tend to work fairly well, and it's one of Maine's BMP standards.
Okay.
It's an established standard.
Okay, I'd like to get that.
There are certainly occasions when they don't, when they're not constructed well, but I have faith.
Okay. Barbara.
There was also a question about quality, you know, the quality of the water as it goes through them. I don't know enough to know anything about that.
Okay. Just to kind of go back, if we're going back to the, right back to the beginning, when we applied it was October and it was the old rules. Water quality is not part of the old rules. However, that said, there are buffer strips. When you go into the level lip spreader, the water goes into the level lip spreader. The water then flows off of that into this already wooded area, which is a buffer strip.
And it is a form of quality treatment. So there is quality treatment within it. We don't address it specifically because it's not required.
Mr. Keck had raised a number of questions, and I was trying to take down as many notes as I could. One of his questions was, how does frozen ground absorb water? How does rock absorb water? Could you address those issues that he raised?
Okay.
He's not here right now, but anyway, go ahead.
Specifically, frozen ground doesn't absorb water in the pre-condition or in the post-condition. So your conditions going into this, you know, before your development and after your development, winter's going to stay the same, ground's going to stay the same, it's going to do the same thing. Your model takes that into account. You have a pre and a post. You're looking at the same point of interest, say, prior to development and after development. So it doesn't, you're not necessarily looking at frozen ground or bedrock. Does that
so help? I think you've given me the answer that I was anticipating, that there that condition already exists.
Yes.
At this area,
yes,
of land.
Yes.
Okay.
And the development won't change that.
Right. I just want to, while you're here, I just want to see if there are any other questions that arose. He also raised an issue as to test pits and borings by a certified geologist that the soils can absorb the quantities of water that would be running over this area of land. I don't know if that's something that you could speak to, or whether our town planner could speak to, whether that's something that we have typically required in the past. Do you want to?
I'll start, and hopefully you'll jump in really soon. I'm assuming that when you prepared your pre-development flows, you took into consideration soil characteristics.
Yes.
So you used the medium-intensity soil survey.
Yes.
That would, you know, help you identify areas of exposed ledge that would factor in that there's zero absorption in those areas. And in addition, soil types that are complexes that include ledge near the surface.
Yes.
So it's part of the pre- and post-development flow estimates that you've already,
yes,
created?
Yes.
Okay. Does that make sense?
Yes. Do you have anything to add?
No.
Okay, it's 10:30.
Let me ask a question.
Go ahead, Jack.
We're talking about a model here, right?
Yes.
I think the questions perhaps that were implicit in the points raised by Mr. Keck was, is there any data to support the model, any test data of the soil types, how much ledge there is, things like that?
At that particular site, probably not, but there are years and years and years of data from the Soil Conservation Service. This isn't a model that we just dreamed up. It's a...
No, I understand. I understand.
So there's...
Well, let me ask you, how vulnerable or how fragile is the model and its application to this site without any test data from the site itself?
Well, that really depends on the information that you're trying to get. If what you're trying to do is compare what happens at a particular point before development and after development, you know, you're going to be in pretty good shape. If you're looking at an exact number for the flow coming to a certain point, it's not, you're not going to get that exact number. Does that answer your question, or am I way off?
Sure. I mean, I think what the neighbors are concerned about, obviously, is how much increased flooding.
Okay. Okay. And if that's the concern, I can answer that. We looked at 8 different points of interest, and we looked at the pre-development condition, and we used the model to evaluate what happens in the pre-development condition given the ground types, the soil types and the ground condition. We make that same evaluation for those same points of interest after we've done our development, okay? And when we look and compare the two, we don't have a significant increase in the flow at that particular point of interest. And how that affects the wetlands further on down, we've done an evaluation to look at the height that the development would cause that water level to be raised, and it's less than an inch in a 25-year storm.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Were there any other questions?
I have one.
Okay.
One thing was brought up for the first time tonight. I'm not sure who can answer it, but Maureen, perhaps you could speak to it. And that was that the code does require that the affordable housing be in concert with the rest of the development, and yet that house is not going to be. It is a 40-year-old house.
May I make a suggestion? Or I just want to see if we're done with the issue of stormwater before
we go on
to
another issue.
That's no problem.
That's right. Wrong Maureen.
You ready to answer that question? Okay. So I think then I appreciate your interest in discussing that issue while your experts are here. Why don't we deal with the affordable housing issue, and then I would suggest we table. Let's just do it. Your concern was that the old house would not be
brought that up before, and perhaps that's something we should look at. The code does say something about it being. I mean, we've had that problem before, that the whatever is built has to be in conformity with the other units, and this one is not going to be. It is a 30 to 40 year old house, and my understanding is nothing's going to be done to it except it's just going to be changed in direction.
Can you answer this?
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. If the board remembers, the Whaleback Ridge subdivision, which is on Old Ocean House Road, right across from Trundy Road, that project proposed a 5-lot subdivision in the RA district, so we're talking 30,000 square foot lots, cluster development, and the 6th lot was an existing ranch. And the applicant put a deed restriction on that ranch as a moderate income home, and the other homes built in that development are, in the $600,000 range. And the board found that consistent with our ordinance. So we have since, buffed up the standards of the ordinance, but what we've done is we've talked about things like number of bedrooms and, the quality of the construction has to be the same, but the size does not have to be the same. So it is finally a determination by the planning board whether that house is compatible with the remainder of the project in terms of affordable housing, but we do have this Whaleback Ridge precedent that you may have already set.
My concern would be if the home were not a single family home like the rest in the proposed neighborhood, that it had one bedroom, unlike the rest of the homes in the neighborhood. It had no garage. It seems to me the age of the house is less important of a factor than that it's in conformity with the types of homes that would be built. So I don't view that as
in terms of amenities.
Right.
Like I said, I would agree with Dave. Meaning, I'm not saying it is or it isn't, Barbara. I think you're concerned.
Well, it's just that somebody brought it up. I thought it was interesting. Nobody ever brought that up before. I thought it was kind of an interesting point.
Okay. Unless I hear a protest from other members of the board, I would suggest we table this application to the next meeting of the planning board, which is the third Tuesday in June. So moved.
Having discussed this for now 3 hours, I move that we table this application until the next regular meeting, June 20th.
Second. The only discussion point is, it seems to me, we do want to see a sidewalk plan.
Yes.
And a design for the gate. And whether the gate might move to a new location if the Maxwell property is developed on the road is something we can talk about.
Next time.
Okay. Any further discussion? Did you have a question?
Good question.
Right. I mean, the question we were wrestling with, I guess, is as far as where the gate goes. I mean, if you're moving it to Chicory, then not really sure what, that there's any reason to do the sidewalk. The applicant isn't sending any traffic through there.
No.
I guess we don't know that. I mean, it could be 8 years from now.
10 years.
10 years from now.
We don't know when the Maxwell property will be developed, if at all. So if it were moved 30 years from now, it seems to me there's a benefit to having a sidewalk. If it if Maxwell property came along and were developed next year, I understand your point, but we really can't predict that.
Well, maybe it could be tied to a certain number of years.
I think, okay, is the question, the current location, okay? I mean, is that what you're trying to find out from us? What is it you're trying to find out from us?
Well, that's one thing, obviously. If you're going to put the gate as we had proposed it on the plan, then there is traffic that's going out, obviously, onto Columbus. But if we're going to be putting on a Chicory, there would be no traffic going out on Columbus.
The only thing I've heard is the only way it would go on Chicory is if the Maxwell property were developed, and whether we impose that condition or not, I don't have a clue. I'm not sure that's been proposed by some of the residents as something that might make sense, but I don't think the board has thoroughly had a chance to discuss that issue. And I'm given that the traffic will be going through the Columbus Road neighborhood for a period of time, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 100 years, it seems to me that the sidewalk condition makes sense. David?
I would, I don't know how to phrase this, but I would kind of like to hear what some of the residents on Columbus have to say about the sidewalk if the gate does go in initially. In other words, what we're talking about is the gate going in initially, but there are other people on the board here that feel that a sidewalk should be built regardless. I'm curious, as maybe they can write some letters and let us know. Maybe we get some feel for the neighbors in there, whether they'd want a sidewalk imposed on them now or wait. So.
Yeah, because we probably misunderstood that or something, because when we held the neighborhood meetings, they were all very clear that when they went through it, that they wanted the gate. That was their traffic calming measure, if you will. So I guess we were a little unclear that there'd also be a sidewalk once that decision was reached.
But I think they wanted the gate on Chicory so all the traffic would go out that little tiny
Actually, that night, we actually were discussing...
Don't protect your other neighbors on the other side.
That night, we actually were discussing it as proposed in this. I wasn't clear on that, but they were proposing it because they made that clear during the public meeting.
The board has asked for a plan on the sidewalk. I'd like to get a sense from the board on how detailed you want this. I mean, doing a sidewalk plan in Columbus is a lot of work on our part. We've got to go out and survey the entire corridor, and we've got to engineer it. And I thought I heard the board say this evening that they want the sidewalk with the esplanade, except in the case of trees. And my visual observation
serious grading problems.
Right. And my visual observation during the site visit was that is going to be 90% of the stretch. There were not many obstacles or many trees in the way of that 5 and 5. And also, I mean, my read of that. That visit was that at least 50% of the neighbors didn't want the sidewalk. So why are we going to all of this expense and effort where we may not have the sidewalk?
Well, I'm inclined to require a sidewalk, period. I've said that from the very beginning. I'm inclined to require it. And I think from a planning standpoint, it's a disaster to throw a gate in the middle of this neighborhood and say that's it for traffic calming. I don't think it's going to calm the traffic that you are most concerned about, which is half of the 20 or of the 40 homes are going to go through Columbus Road, regardless of whether when there's a gate there. And so all those extra trips, it seems to me, a sidewalk makes sense from a planning standpoint. And I thought I heard from a number of residents tonight that they like the idea of a sidewalk, provided that it did not take out existing trees and And if there's a significant slope issue, which I do recall, at least in, I mean, one property seemed to be the most affected by that, and that was a Leighton's.
Right.
I didn't see many others that were, but, you know, as far as detail, well, that's my opinion on it. I don't know if other board members agree with me or not.
Agreed.
Killed him, yes or no?
What do you, I think Mr. Mitchell asked how much detail you want, and that's what he's concerned about.
Well, that was the one of the questions, yes. I mean, and I agree, that's a fair question. I don't know if we simply identify by property name and number the area that the sidewalk might deviate from the typical 5-foot esplanade.
I would just suggest, Mr. Chairman, for Mr. Mitchell's benefit, that if you could draw this reasonably to scale on an aerial, that would be a good first start. I'm not looking for you to engineer it at this point, given the fact that we don't know for certain whether the board's position is on a final decision on a gate.
Okay.
But at least something on an aerial where it's discernible where a sidewalk and an esplanade might go and the reasonable limit of where that might end would be, I think, in my opinion, a good starting point.
And that's fair. I mean, lessens the expense, especially if we decide that's not the direction going in. But I guess I'm looking at sort of, I won't say property by property, but pretty close to it, where the sidewalk's going to go. Because I don't have a mind at Davis. And I'm still hopeful on the gate.
Is that on Killdeer or not?
Does that include Killdeer?
Killdeer, as it loops towards the view of the Moran property, I think we ought to see a sidewalk plan there, and it may be that we decide that we don't go for that little loop. As I mentioned, it may be that for traffic calming, it's not as necessary there because it's such a short distance. It's unlikely cars could gain enough speed
to
become hazardous.
Columbus. Yes.
Yep. Okay. Any other direction? Okay. All right, we have had a motion to adjourn, and I believe it's been seconded. So, any further discussion? No? Okay. All those in favor? The motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you.